Are you ready for some football?
Man, what are y'all watching? Nice.
Man, that's like their fourth outfit in the last 10 minutes. Talk about your two-minute drill.
Man, I'd like to be a fly on that wall backstage.
Bridget, that's just not true. Seattle's got new unis, a new stadium. Sean Alexander, they are ready to make a move.
They've already moved Sophie to the NFC West. Frisco's going Garcia to Owens all night.
Two words for you, Bridget Hall. Chad Brown.
Two words for you, Sophie Dahl. Bryant Young.
Dilfer. What are you doing?
Getting ready for some football!
Strutting down the runway and onto the Monday night stage comes Sean Alexander and the Seattle Seahawks. The third-year running back has exhibited a flair for the primetime lights and comes off a game in which he scored an NFL record 5 first-half touchdowns. But tonight, top billing is reserved for Jeff Garcia and Terrell Owens, the headliners who key the NFC West-leading San Francisco 49ers. It's showtime in the Pacific Northwest as two new division rivals meet on ABC's Monday Night Football.
Does this make me look bad?
Yeah.
Are you ready for some football? Put the pedal to the metal and somebody's fear. Tonight, the NFL kicks it into high gear. The Seahawks blew over from the AFC. The Niners show how painful realignment can be. You better sit back, strap in, and hold tight.
On a day like this, there can be no city in America more beautiful than this one, Seattle. And what an early evening. Clear blue skies, temperature 64 degrees, brand new Seahawks Stadium in full throat right now as the Seattle Seahawks come out onto the field to meet the San Francisco 49ers on Monday Night Football. Al Michaels with John Madden and Melissa Stark. Welcome to Seattle, where the 49ers come in feeling pretty good about themselves. A 3-1 record. They come off their best game of the season. They routed the Rams in San Francisco last week. And as they look in their rearview mirror, the Rams, their old nemesis, 1-5. For the Seahawks, I don't think we can overstate the importance of this early season game. They started out 0-3, then they beat Minnesota, had a bye week. Lose tonight, people start saying same old Seahawks, they won't get to the playoffs. Win tonight, 2 in a row, look good on Monday Night Football, only a game back in the NFC West. And John, with so much at stake for the Seahawks, what's their best chance of beating San Francisco?
Well, you know, having been around here for 3 days, the Seahawks players realize that, and I think that's the first thing you have to do is know that this is big, and everyone believe that this is a big game for them. But the first thing they have to do is stop the run. Now, if they've had any one problem, it's stopping the run. So the one thing they get back tonight is they get John Randall. Now, we've known John Randall, the defensive tackle, for years with the Minnesota Vikings. And he's not a great run player, but he has so much energy and so much passion and so much enthusiasm that I think the coaches and players just hope that the whole defense feeds off him.
Very important for them to get him back tonight. 49ers, of course, have Jeff Garcia at the helm, but an excess of riches at running back, unlike a lot of teams in the league.
And I think when someone is having a problem, we talk about the Seahawks are having a problem stopping the run, you have to check that first. Is that problem still there? And you have to give him Garrison Hurst, and you have to give him Kevin Barlow. I think Kevin Barlow, the backup running back, could be the best-kept secret in the NFL. Garrison Hurst and Kevin Barlow alternate every series. And if the Seattle Seahawks can't stop them, they're going to get a big dose of those two.
Niners with a great 1-2 punch. So two new NFC West rivals. Seattle changing divisions. Monday Night Football from the Great Northwest. Tonight's quarterback comparison is brought to you by McDonald's. San Francisco's Jeff Garcia has gone from undrafted and unknown to two Pro Bowl appearances. He threw 63 touchdown passes over the past two seasons. Trent Dilfer's strong performance at the end of last season earned him the Seahawks' starting job this season. Dilfer has won 17 of his last 20 regular season starts. 2 weeks ago tonight, Ray Lewis had a huge night on Monday Night Football. Then it was Brett Favre's turn last week in Champaign, Illinois. What about tonight? Will Terrell Owens shine? Or might it be Sean Alexander? Under the lights in Seattle on Monday Night Football.
ABC Sports welcomes you to the following presentation of the National Football League.
Wow, what a greeting. That's next door. That's Safeco Field, home of the Mariners, and we're across the parking lot at Seahawks Stadium, right next door. Brand new Seahawks Stadium. And the big man for the Seahawks, Sean Alexander, he's with Melissa Stark. Hi, Melissa.
Hey, Al. Well, the last time we saw this man, he set an NFL record with 5 touchdowns in the first half against Minnesota. But in talking to your coaches and teammates, they say that's no big deal for you. You expect that. Where did that mentality come from?
I think probably back in the fourth grade, I ran a kickoff back and a little playing peewee footballs. Scored about 4 touchdowns that day, and it was real exciting. I got all this attention. I think I found out what I like to do. I want to score some touchdowns, so I've been trying to do that ever since.
You're certainly becoming a primetime player. You got another chance here tonight. When you look at the 49er defense, where can you personally have success against them?
They're so athletic. We just got to just kind of run at them. You know, if we can control the line of scrimmage, I'll be able to break some things in the fourth quarter. Hopefully I get it done in the second, though.
Good luck tonight.
All right, I'll see you later.
All right, Al. Well, Alexander needs 3 touchdowns to tie the NFL record of 8 over 2 consecutive games. It's held by Jim Taylor and Marshall Faulk.
All right, Melissa, the Sunday night star. We'll see what he can do on Monday. The Seahawks have been off now for 15 days. Come off a bye. Jimmy Williams is back to receive for San Francisco, along with Terry Jackson and Ryan Lindell. To kick off for the Seahawks. Beautiful early evening. Here we go. Flashbulbs popping in Seattle as the kick comes down to the 11-yard line. Taken there by Terry Jackson. And he brings it back out to the 26 as we meet the San Francisco offensive unit.
Jeff Garcia, San Jose State.
Harrison Hurst, the one and only Georgia.
Fred Beasley, Auburn.
Terrell Owens, University of Tennessee at Chattanooga.
Ty Streets, Michigan.
Eric Johnson, Yale.
Derek Deese, USC.
Eric Heitman, Stanford.
Jeremy Newberry, Cal Berkeley.
Ron Stone, Boston College.
Scott Gregg, Montana.
Good offensive line, and then running game for San Francisco, collectively averaging 5.4 yards per carry. Play action on the first play, pass thrown, caught. Close to a first down, that's Ty Streets, and he is going to see a lot of action tonight because J.J. Stokes is hurt, and he's on the inactive list.
It was interesting. The Seahawks come up there, and they have 8 guys. You see, they have the extra guy in the box, so that tells the 49ers that you don't want to run against that. You just throw the ball. So they just bring Ty Streets up, and he runs a hook. You see, now Jeff Garcia gets back, takes that little hitch, and puts the ball right in there to Ty Streets. I think that's a good way to start. When you don't have J.J. Stokes, you have a new guy, get him the ball quickly.
Second and one, and they spread it out with 3 receivers to the right and then give it to Hurst on the ground. He picks up the first down against this Seattle starting defensive unit.
Lamar King, Saginaw Valley State.
Chad Eaton, Washington State.
John Randall, Texas A&I.
Antonio Cochran, Georgia.
Chad Brown, University of Colorado.
Isaiah Kazavinsky, Harvard.
Marcus Bell, Arizona.
Sean Springs, The Ohio State University.
Reggie Tung, Oregon State.
Marcus Robertson, Iowa State.
Ken Lucas, Mississippi.
First down from the 40-yard line now, and Garcia slings it to the near side, and that's caught by Streets, who's covered by Lucas on the play. You know, and that's a first down.
One of the interesting things, Al, in the Seahawks, Sean Springs, who's the best corner for the Seahawks, is going man-to-man. He's matching up with Terrell Owens. So both of those passes, they stayed away from Terrell Owens, and they stayed away from Sean Springs. Here's Ty Streets again. As you said, you see him on Lucas. He just runs them up, you know, gets on that outside shoulder, and then just breaks it off, and Jeff Garcia times it perfectly.
Now you have Owens in the slot to the right. Streets outside, keep it on the ground, give it to Hurst, and he is stopped for no gain. Maybe a loss of one. The Harvardian, Kesavinsky, makes the tackle. Mike Holmgren, of course, had so much success at Green Bay, came here, huge contract, got all of the power and autonomy that he couldn't get with Ron Wolf at Green Bay, made the playoffs his first year, but out of the playoffs the last two. Steve Mariucci, meanwhile, in his sixth season at San Francisco. Hurst and Barlow are both in the backfield now, and now Hurst comes out as a flanker to the left. Seahawks show blitz, and here they come. And down goes Garcia in the arms of Chad Eaton, the former New England Patriot. And a flag is down.
Yeah, we talk about John Randall coming back and the energy and the defensive guys feeding off him. You can just feel that already. And one of those guys is going to be Chad Eaton. You know, because you look at John Randall and you know you have to get some
personal
help there.
Foul, face mask. Defense, 15, first down.
That's Kazuvinsky from Harvard, and Bill Levy is the referee. Levy refereeing his first ever Monday night game in his second year as a ref.
Harry Kiteman is number 66 right here. He's a rookie from Stanford, and watch what Eaton does to him. You see, he just gets him. He gets him standing straight up. Now, when you get in that position and you're stood straight up, you have no power. So Eaton could just take him and just push him and run him right into the backfield.
Taking the place of Dave Fiore, the left guard who's on IR and gone for the year. And Hurst now takes it to the 38. So the Seahawks' first big defensive play gets negated by the face mask.
Trying to get this crowd into this defense to get them fired up. You know, they know that they need that energy. I mean, they don't, in their front seven, they don't really have a dominant player. I mean, their best player is Chad Brown, and their linebackers haven't been able to get off blocks, and they haven't, you know, been a good tackling defense, and they hope to change all those things tonight. There's a good player right there, number 94.
Second down and six. And it's dropped by Hurst. Kazavinsky on the blitz that time. John talking about Chad Brown, number 94, the former Steeler. Now split his career between these two teams. Third down and six coming up.
Kazavinsky, you see, he's a middle linebacker right here. He's been on a couple plays early. You see, they're bringing him on one side, bringing the safety on the other side. The guard has to pick. Again, they're attacking Eric Heitman. You know, make him make the decision. He takes the safety, the linebacker's free.
Six defensive backs now for Seattle. Third down and six from the 38-yard line. 3.5 minutes into the game. Seahawks rush forward. Garcia throws, caught on the run by Owens. And when Owens catches it on the run, he's normally going to pick up a lot more yardage and a first down here at the 23-yard line. 14-yard gain.
And that's the thing. You always have to get the ball to Terrell Owens, but you have to move him around. Now, Sean Springs has been on, but watch him. They take him over here, and they bring him in motion. You see, they bring him down so that Sean Springs can't get on him, can't get that hit, can't put that zone to him, and then he just runs a crossing pattern. I'll tell you, when they're zoning and they're rolling to a guy and they're always going to zone and roll to Terrell Owens, that is a great pattern.
First and 10 from the 23 on the opening drive of the game. Here comes the blitz, and Garcia is going to sling it away. Nearby that time was Beasley, but he was just throwing it away because of Marcus Bell's blitz.
I think what they were trying to do is run a screen pass to Garrison Hurst. And the screen pass got fouled up. Hurst didn't get out there, so Garcia didn't want to take the sack. So instead of taking the sack, he just threw it away. And you can throw it away deep if there's a receiver in that area. And as you said, Beasley was there, but in essence, he really wasn't the receiver.
Right. Only the Jets are worse defensively than Seattle against the run. The Niners, number three on the ground. That is caught by Hurst at the 20-yard line. Gain of a couple, stopped that time by Marcus Bell.
You were talking to the 49ers, and they do an interesting thing now. You know, they always had that script, the first 15 plays. And when Johnny Unitas passed away, in honor of Johnny Unitas, Steve Mariucci said that he wanted a 19-play script. And they did that week, and they're going to do it every other week. So instead of having just their first 15 script, Johnny Unitas was number 19. They now have their first 19 plays scripted.
That normally takes you into the second quarter. Garcia very hot thus far this season on third down. And that time it's off the fingertips of Cedric Wilson. Now Wilson is going to see more action tonight than normal because they move Streets into the starting lineup. And now Wilson becomes number three. Lucas covering on the play, and the Niners will have to settle for a field goal attempt.
And that's not bad defense for Seattle either, you know, because the 49ers came out, as you said, they were pretty hot, but at least they can hold them to this and the field goal attempt rather than the seven.
Now Cortez, whose longest this season is 36, will attempt a 37-yard field goal. And the kick is good. So the Niners have the ball for about the first 5 minutes of the game and break on top in Seattle. San Francisco 3, the Seahawks nothing. ABC's Monday Night Football being brought to you by Madden NFL 2003 from EA Sports. It's in the game. Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler. Be you, nothing's better, Dr. Pepper. Chrysler, drive equals love. And Coors Light, the official beer sponsor of the NFL. Cold down easy. Beautiful shots of Seattle sunset here. Temperature 64 at game time. Niners driving down the field, settling for three, and now Cortez, who gave them the lead, kicks off, fielded by Maurice Morris, rookie. Back to the 25-yard line, the rookie out of Oregon, their second-round draft choice. And that's where Seattle will set up shop with 10:01 to go in the opening period. Trent Dilfer coming out onto the field, 3-0 San Francisco. Aerial coverage being provided by Southwest Airlines as the sun goes down over Puget Sound. Downtown Seattle in the foreground. Just perfect. From the 25-yard line, Seattle on first down, and Dilfer is going to go deep. And the receiver and defensive backs get their feet tangled up. It's Darryl Jackson and Ahmed Plummer. Incidental contact, no flag, incomplete, second and 10.
Ben Dilfer is going to come out and try and get it right away, and he's going after his favorite receiver, Darryl Jackson. You see, he slipped a little there. Plummer has great coverage. You know that you run with the guy, you put your head back so you look at, but you keep your hand out there so you can feel him and always know where he is.
Second and 10 from the 25-yard line. Tossed back to Alexander. Good little move to the outside. And then he's taken down after a gain of three by Ulbrich. Let's take a look at the Seattle offense.
Trent Dilfer, Fresno State.
Sean Alexander, the University of Alabama.
Max Strong, Georgia.
Corn, the Natural Roberts, North Carolina State.
Darryl Jackson, Florida.
Itula Mealy, BYU.
Walter Jones, Florida State.
Chris Gray, Auburn.
Robbie Toback, Washington State.
Floyd Redburn, Penn State.
Florida Womack, Mississippi State.
Floyd Porkchop. Womack.
Whatever happened to nicknames? I mean, it's great to have a game where the tackle's nicknamed Porkchop.
A third down and 8. Intercepted at the Seattle 45-yard line by Zach Bronson, and he takes it back to the 38-yard line. And Zach Bronson is a guy who normally is in the area. He has made 9 interceptions now in his last 12 regular season games, and he puts the 49ers in business 6 minutes into the game.
Yeah, I was just saying last night, I was watching the film, and every game that I ever see of the 49ers play, Zach Bronson always makes a big play. And here it is, he's just a safety. He's going to be sitting back here free, and you just see the ball is thrown over the receiver's head, and Bronson is just back there reading, and it's thrown right to him. See, the coverage was pretty good. Bronson wasn't in on the coverage. Bronson was about 5 yards behind the coverage. They just threw a flag down there.
12 men in the huddle. Offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Ooh, that's that old thing, that old lingering in the huddle where, you know, you send 12 in the huddle and then one runs out just before the snap of the ball, and you don't know if they're 2 tight ends, 3 wide receivers. And remember the Raiders did that a couple weeks ago.
Interesting there. I think Barlow may have been the 12th guy on the huddle as you look at Bronson, and Barlow and Hurst alternate series. Now, Garrison started the first series, and then in a two-back set, you'll see Barlow come in, and this is Barlow's series to start. And he's in there. He's the tailback from the 43-yard line. First down and 15 now, and they give it to him. He gets inside the 40, and Barlow takes it to the 37-yard line.
Yeah, we're talking to Steve Sidwell, who is the defensive coordinator of the Seahawks, and he says, Kevin Barlow may be the best back in this league that no one knows. And I think when you're a defensive coordinator like Steve Sidwell, who's been one for a heck of a long time and a very good one, you've seen them all. And when you see a good one, you know it. And I remember seeing Kevin Barlow in the preseason and training camp. And I'll tell you, this guy is a totally different guy than he was from a year ago.
He's a bull, 6'1", 238 pounds. First time out of the shotgun now. Garcia moving to his left, under pressure, gets dumped by Chad Brown. Incomplete.
Did you see that move that Chad Brown made? You know, Chad Brown has a move, and it's a spin move. And he'll make this move, and he'll spin inside or he'll spin outside. I talked to Derek Deese about it last night. He was worried about that move, and he got beat on it right away. You see right here, here he comes. He makes a spin, and now he's inside. Jeff Garcia sees it and feels it and has to get out of the pocket. It's interesting to see Derek Deese say he has a great spin move. I'm not sure what to do against it.
Brown quick as ever, 10th year in the league. Garcia slings it on third down, coming back and making the catch inbound, Cedric Wilson. Great grab going to the ground and having the presence of mind to come down inbounds.
And that was the thing that Steve Mariucci was saying. The guy that has to play well is Cedric Wilson, because when Ty Street starts, now Cedric Wilson, number 84 there, he becomes the third wide receiver, and we want to use a lot of our zebra set or three wide receiver set. So, in essence, he's darn near a starter.
First catch of the season for him. Now it's Beasley breaking a tackle, and Beasley, the fullback, takes it down to the 24-yard line. Kazuwinski making the hit.
The 49ers have great mixture. I like the way they call plays. You know, you can never say, well, this is what they are. They trap all the time. They run inside all the time. You know, they always run to the halfback. I mean, they'll run it. They'll pass. They'll play pass. They'll run it to the fullback. And I think that, you know, when you talk about the West Coast offense, it all started here under Bill Walsh, and they're still the masters of it.
They're almost at the end of the script, John. This is the 16th play. They've scripted 19, and we still have half the quarter to go. Garcia, and incomplete, off Garrison Hurst's fingertips, flagged down, however, in the secondary, down at the 16-yard line.
And the 17th play in the script was a very good one. It was a bootleg, and he not only had Garrison Hurst, I think he had Terrell Owens open, too.
And you have illegal contact against the Seahawks.
Illegal use of the hands to the face. Number 24, defense. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Sean Springs, who missed the Minnesota game with a foot injury.
And we know that Sean Springs is going to be on Terrell Owens. And Sean Springs says that's one of the things that he wanted to do, is he wanted to be physical with him. He wanted to get up on him and bump him. And you see that he did get up there and he was physical, but that jam started on his shoulder pad and went right up to his face. That was a perfect pass. Garrison Hurst should have had that, or Garcia could have thrown to Terrell Owens.
And then the Niners get the break because of the penalty. Quick flip, near side. Streets staying in bounds after the catch and getting it inside the 10 to the 9-yard line.
Don't these 49er receivers all kind of look alike? I mean, they're all in this West Coast offense. I remember years ago, Bill Walsh saying this and Ron Wolf saying this. There's J.J. Stokes, who isn't playing tonight, that to play this offense, you have to have big wide receivers. Little receivers cannot play in this offense, in this game. And all these 49er receivers all look alike. They even activated a guy, James Jordan, tonight, and he looks just like Terrell Owens.
So Bill Walsh sitting next to Terry Donahue as Garcia rolls, throws, it's Owens into the end zone. Touchdown, San Francisco.
Well, they got something going. They knew that Sean Springs was going to be on Terrell Owens, so they started to move Terrell Owens. And if you look, that every time he's come on a crossing pattern, on that play there was no one on him. But watch him. He's going to start off here, and then he's going to come across. You see, he starts out there like he's going to come in, and then he just works to the end, and there was no one there. I mean, the closest guy was to Chad Brown, and how you can forget to cover Terrell Owens, I have no idea.
Cortez for the point after. Owens makes the 61st touchdown catch of his career. The 49ers have run 17 plays. The Seahawks have run three. 10-0, 49ers. Saturday, Maurice Claret, freshman sensation at Ohio State. You'll see him in action. Buckeyes going to Camp Randall Stadium in Madison to face Wisconsin. Those regional games at 3:30 Eastern right here on ABC Sports. All right, now the Hawks from the 31-yard line as Dilfer retreats and gets tripped up. Trying to get out of the pocket, and Andre Carter will get the sack.
And all Andre Carter did was get one hand there on Dilfer. You know, Dilfer has a bad knee, right knee. In fact, he has a brace on his right knee, and he's not the most nimble of guys. Here you're going to see Andre Carter right here on Walter Jones, and he has good speed. He gets around. Jones has him every way he can get him, and Carter just put that right hand out there and swiped it and got Dilfer down.
On second and 11, Alexander goes to the outside. Gets tackled there after a minimal game by Tony Parrish. Here's the 49er defensive unit.
Chikezie Okifor, Purdue.
Brian Young, Notre Dame.
Dana Stubblefield, University of Kansas.
Andre Carter, California.
Julian Peterson, Michigan State.
Derek Smith, Arizona State.
Jeff Ulbrich, Hawaii.
Ahmed Plummer, Ohio State.
Tony Parrish, Washington.
Zach Brunson, McNeese State.
Jason Webster, Texas A&M.
And the defensive coordinator, Jim Mora Jr. Dad, of course, coached for many years at New Orleans, then Indianapolis, now just enjoying life in the Southern California desert. Dad is. Now Junior, he just watches Bobby Engram make a catch against his defensive unit, and enough for a first down.
This is one of the things the Seahawks want to do tonight. We talked about the 49ers playing three wide receivers and zebra, and the Seahawks would like to do the same thing. And then if you can spread them out, if they will spread out with you, then you run the ball. If they stay in tight, then you throw the ball. Here's a three wide receiver set again. Two wide receivers on this side, one wide receiver on the far side.
Took the Seahawks nearly 10 minutes to get their first down. From the 43 now, off the fake, Dilfer guns it, and it's incomplete. Darryl Jackson, the intended receiver, third-year guy who played for Steve Spurrier at Florida.
Yeah, Dilfer looks a little jumpy here, and what he's doing is audibilizing, and they get into formation, like I said, the three wide receivers, and if they have an extra guy in the box, he's going to audibilize to a pass. If they spread out, then he's going to audibilize to the run. That time they had the extra guy in the box, he audibilized to the pass, threw it incomplete, now second and long. Here again, you see the extra guy in the box, so this has to be a throw, and he runs.
And he runs with it. But they didn't need any more guys in the box. The defensive line takes care of Alexander after a minimal gain. I'm looking at these two quarterbacks, John. I'm thinking, you realize that Dilfer is 2 years younger than Garcia? It seems like Dilfer has been around forever. And, of course, you know, Jeff had a long road before he finally made it with the 49ers.
Right. Jeff was around for a long time, but he wasn't around the NFL.
Right.
He was up in Canada, and he did it the hard way, but I'll tell you, he's a hard-working, persistent guy, Jeff Garcia is.
Dilfer, of course, was the sixth pick overall in the 94 draft by Tampa Bay. Slings it over the middle and into the arms of Bobby Engram. So Engram twice now has gone over the middle on third down to move the chains. 19-yard pickup that time.
Yeah, I'll tell you, Trent Dilfer threw the ball perfectly in the perfect hole. Tony Parrish, the strong safety, was deep. And he comes late on a blitz. And you're going to see number 33. He's going to come right there. You see him? Well, he comes. Well, the hole that he left is a hole that Trent Dilfer threw the ball in. You see Parrish come up there, you see him leave, and you see Engram go right in the spot that Parrish had just left.
3.5 to go in the period. Ball at the 49-37. And Dilfer throws, and making the catch is Darryl Jackson, and he takes the ball inside the 20. They'll spot it at the 18.
Darryl Jackson made a heck of a move out there on Jason Webster. He started like he was going to come in on a slant, and then he went back to the outside, and Guilford threw it at the perfect time. Watch him. Here he is, and he's going to come, and he's going to come like he's working in. You see that? And Jason Webster just held for a minute, and then he got in behind him. Now, when he made that move, Trent Dilfer gave a little pump and brought him back and hit him.
First and 10. This time he goes underneath to Itula Mealy, the tight end, and he's inside the 10 and close to a first down. Jeff Ulbrich makes the tackle. Trent Dilfer with Tampa. Then he goes to Baltimore, and all he does is win the Super Bowl, and they say goodbye. 7-1 with the Ravens in the regular season as a starter, then 4-0 in the playoffs, which included the Super Bowl, and good night. They went with Elvis Gerback. Dilfer came here to play under Mike Holmgren. 2nd and 1 from the 9-yard line. 3 receivers set to the left, keep it on the ground. Alexander picks up the first down. It'll be first and goal from the 5.
You know, a lot of teams are doing this in the NFL now. Remember early in the season, they started the spread out offense and throwing the ball quickly. And then as the defenses started to adjust to it, then they started running out of those passing formations. That last formation there, the Seahawks got one. They had 3 wide receivers out to the left, which tells the defense, okay, this is a passing down and then a passing situation, a passing formation, and they run the ball.
49ers have not allowed a first quarter touchdown in the last 8 regular season games, the last 4 last year and all 4 this year. On first and goal, Dilfer on a slant, hits Max Strong, touchdown. 2 big third down completions to Bobby Engram along the way, and the Seahawks get back in it.
Right after I said Trent Dilfer looks a little jumpy out there, he really calmed down and he started shredding this 49er defense, throwing perfect passes to the perfect guy. And it all started on that Tony Parrish blitz. Tony Parrish blitz, you know, and he hit right in there in that hole, and that was the play that got the Seahawks started. Man can get excited.
Strong's 5th reception of the season. Ryan Lindell for the point after. And so after a near disastrous start for Seattle, Dilfer twice on 3rd and 9 in each instance hits Engram, and then it's paid off at the end with a touchdown pass to Strong, and the Niner lead is 3. 46-year-old Steve Mariucci pacing the sidelines on the left. Mike Holmgren at 54. Mike, a San Francisco native, went to high school there, coached with the 49ers under Bill Walsh, then George Seifert, before moving on to Green Bay and eventually winning a Super Bowl there.
And then in Green Bay, he still has that street named after. We were in Green Bay in the preseason, and we drove down Holmgren Avenue.
We did. Mariucci was on Holmgren's staff for a couple of years in Green Bay.
12-yard line. Coaches were.
Yeah. Terry Jackson up to the 25-yard line.
You know, Jeff Garcia is an interesting guy in that he's not a scrambler, but he moves well in the pocket. If you look at the pocket here, now you can scramble in or out of the pocket or move. Now, what he does, he'll get back in the pocket, and then he'll hop a couple times to find a lane and throw. And some of his passes are even jump passes like that one, but he doesn't run out right or doesn't run out left a lot, but he stays in the pocket and then moves right or left and then can really get a run and launch the ball sometimes.
Part of that great 49er tradition, as you can see, plus 20 in each of 2 consecutive seasons, only the 2nd quarterback in history to do it. Brett Favre was the other. Pretty good company. First down. They give it to Hurst. I mean, you think about Garcia, and you know, John, when you think about the 49er quarterbacks, I think about Yankee center fielders, Montreal Canadian goalies, and you know, in modern times, you think about Montana and Young, of course, but go back to Y.A. Tittle and Frankie Albert and John Brody. Sure,
yeah.
And then
I mean,
there's Garcia.
They always had great quarterbacks, great offense, great passing games, and they lucked out in getting Jeff Garcia. They thought Jim Druckenmiller was going to be that next guy, and they made a mistake there and lucked into Jeff Garcia.
Bill Walsh loved him from the outset. 2nd and 7, and Garcia slinging it deep, and
is made inside the 40 by Ty Streets. But a hat is down.
Well, a hat is down and a flag is down. And I'll bet you Ty Streets went out of bounds, because when the official throws his flag, I mean, the hat, that means that someone went out of bounds. Then if you go out of bounds, you can't come back in and catch the ball.
Illegally touching a forward pass. Number 89, offense. 5-yard penalty, previous spot. Repeat second down.
That's exactly what it was. Ty Streets was a receiver. Now, when he goes out of bounds, when he steps out of bounds here, then right there, you see his foot right there in the line. Now he can't come back in and be the first guy to touch the ball. So the official sees that. When he goes out of bounds, he throws his hat. Now it's all right to go out of bounds and come back in, but you can't be the first guy to touch the ball. So then when he catches a ball, then the flag comes out, because then it becomes a penalty.
Lucas gave him a convenient little push. Just enough.
That's why he went out of bounds.
Second and 12, and they keep it on the ground and give it to Hurst, and he is stopped in his tracks by Orlando Huff, the middle linebacker. Clock ticking down. Great 49er quarterbacks, and we were talking about them, and then the all-time quarterback rating. It's amazing. Kurt Warner, still injured, of course, just under 100. Then Young is second, Montana third, Garcia fourth, all-time.
So would you say it's the guy or the system in the 49ers' case?
A little bit of both.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Third down and 12. And Garcia throws, and that's incomplete. I mean, the system is all well and good, but, you know, it's like every coach says, you still need the players.
Hey, one thing that they're doing is they're going after Jeff Garcia now. I think that he was too comfortable on their first two drives, and then on these last couple, the Seahawk defense started to come after him.
Yep. That time it was Doug Evans on the corner blitz coming after him. So the Niners get off to a roaring start, lead 10-0. Seahawks get back into the game with a long touchdown drive. And now on fourth down, Jason Baker punting for San Francisco. And it's Bobby Engram with a short kick. Flag is down.
You know, the interesting thing, going back to that Joe Montana and Steve Young and Jeff Garcia, look at how long a period that was to have a quarterback. And it's tough to play in this league without a quarterback. And Mike Holmgren is finding that out. I mean, when he was at Green Bay, he had the best in Brett Favre. I remember talking to him one time and said, you know, if you're going to leave Green Bay, take Brett Favre with you and you'll be okay.
Holding. Number 34 of the receiving team during the return. 10-yard penalty. First down. End of the first quarter.
End of the period with the score San Francisco 10. Seattle 7. Monday Night Football back after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Dusk now. I guess it's beyond dusk. Night has fallen. I mean, John, on a day like today, there can't be a more beautiful city in the country.
No, you know, and it's been 3 days this way. I mean, and it's so clean and clear and fresh. You just say, what does it feel like here? It feels fresh.
Here's Dilfer. Taken off. And he's going to pick up the first down. The normally not particularly mobile Trent Dilfer, tackled by Ahmed Plummer after a 13-yard gain.
You know, and that's where the bye has helped the Seahawks, I think, because Trent Dilfer, remember, he got the knee injury early, missed a couple games. They thought it was an MCL, came back, playing with a brace on his right knee. Like, 3 weeks ago, he wouldn't have done this. Even before the bye, he wouldn't have done this. But you can see, he still has a brace on his knee, but he's moving pretty well. I mean, he's moving like, what do you call it, 85% maybe.
Here's Alexander now. He takes it up to the 49-yard line. That's a gain of 4. Tackled by Derek Smith. And we featured Alexander at the beginning of the show tonight. Alexander, first-round pick out of Alabama. His number's right there for the season. He had that phenomenal game on the Sunday night. He had a phenomenal game on the Sunday night last year against Oakland. And clearly, if the Seahawks are going to have success this year, this guy has to have a big season.
You know, I thought an interesting thing you said to Melissa before the game is, I hope to be successful in the fourth quarter. And that's interesting because that's when most running really occurs, most successful running.
Right now he takes it to the 47 here in the second quarter where he's tackled by Tony Parrish.
And that's something, you know, we saw a shot of Bill Walsh earlier and we were talking about this West Coast offense, and Mike Holmgren is a disciple of it, Steve Mariucci. And Bill Walsh was one of the first guys that would start a game passing and then tire you out passing, and then in the second half come back and do the run. You know, the pass to establish a run for years in the history of football was always just the opposite.
You see consultant there. I was talking to Terry Donnie before the game. Bill's in the office almost every day, so he's more than a guy who sits at home and they call him up once in a while. He's there almost all the time.
Yeah, because that's his life and his passion, and that's what he is. I mean, Bill Walsh is a football coach, and he always has been, and no matter what they call you, you always will be.
They're going to measure after that third down rush to the 45-yard line. Mike Holmgren not particularly thrilled by the spot. Looks like they're going to come up a little short, which will create an interesting decision, but they don't. The spot was good enough by a link. One link.
That's all you need is a link.
That's it. 49ers got off to a hot start, but then Seattle with that long touchdown drive, unless the numbers are fairly similar, except for the turnover, which led to the 49er touchdown. That was Bronson's interception of the Dilfer pass. First and 10 now from the 45-yard line. Dilfer, a little screen. Alexander, a couple of blockers out in front, but that is collapsed by the Niner defense. And in on the tackle was Jeff Ulbrich.
Yeah, we were talking to Mike Holmgren about that. You know, that they love to run screen passes, and he was saying that, you know, he's going to do that. That's a big part of his offense, and he loves to do that, to get the ball to his running back out in space. And one thing, the 49ers, because they have so much speed and they're so athletic, they play the screens very well defensively.
Athletic and fast, and they put a premium to the 49ers on rebuilding through that defensive unit through the last couple of drafts. On second and five, that pass is incomplete. The coverage is tight. The crowd thinks it was too tight. The officials say, nope. Jason Webster covering Bobby Engram, who's been living over the middle tonight.
And I think that's where he's always going to live this whole game. Last week, well, they didn't play last week. It was 2 weeks ago in Minnesota. He did the same thing. Bobby Engram is a good possession receiver. I mean, he's one of those guys, you know, that Troy Brown, I mean, those guys that work the middle, work in the slot, and work the middle very, very well.
Former Bear, who had some big seasons in Chicago, played his college ball at Penn State. And there goes Alexander through the middle to pick up the first down. Another big third down conversion for the Seahawks.
Yeah, and that's exactly what we were talking about. And this is Mike Holmgren's game plan tonight, is show them a formation that says pass. Spread them out. Now, if they'll spread out, you see the four wide receivers here spread out. Now you count the box right here. One, two, three, four, five. If they only have five in the box, you have a guy for every guy, so you run the ball. That's his plan. If you have six or seven in the box, then you throw the ball.
Hat on hat, as a lot of coaches say.
That's a line to get your hat on their hat.
That's deflected and wobbles incomplete. I think it was Shiki O'Keefer who got a hand on it. Let's check in with Melissa.
Will Allen, injury update on 49ers defensive end John Engelberger, who is not a starter but rotates in on their defensive end rotation. He has a twisted right ankle. His return is questionable.
So that'll hurt them in terms of depth along the defensive line. The backup defensive tackle is Jim Flanagan. Sean Moran is the other reserve defensive lineman. And there is Jim Flanagan.
Jim Flanagan played all those years for the Bears and the Green Bay Packers. Dad played for the Packers.
Second and 10. That pass caught by Max Strong. You know, you look at Jim Flanagan, even Steve Mariucci didn't know about it. Back in 1995 when he was a Bear, not only did he play well defensively on Monday Night Football, he caught two touchdown passes.
And you asked Steve Mariucci last night if he had Jim Flanagan in his short yardage and goal line offense. And he looked at you and said, what?
What? Why Jim Flanagan? He said.
Yeah. He said, yeah. He said, I didn't know that. He did?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He'll be in the goal line package before the year is done. Third down and six from the 26. Here's Dilfer throwing up his back foot, and it's Alexander making the catch over the middle to the 17. And Seattle has done its best work through the air tonight over the middle.
Yeah, one thing that a quarterback has to do is keep your eyes up, never look at the rush. And watch Trent Dilfer here. There's rushing, there's guys coming in, there's guys going, you know, at his feet and everything. And he stays up there, and he just looks straight down the field. When a quarterback starts to look at the rush, he can't play anymore.
Julian Peterson was in his face. He'll check it off of the line here at the 17 now. Toss back to Alexander, and a good defensive play. That's Webster coming up from the corner to cut him.
Yeah, that's one thing about these corners, and Jim Mora really professes this, that there's no guests on defense. There's no such thing as a cover corner. If they run to your side and you have force of support, you have to get up and make the play. Ahmed Plummer does that. Jason Webster did it. All these guys on this 49er defense, we said they're athletic, we said they're in speed, but they also are good tacklers.
Loss of three, thanks to Webster. Against the four-man front now on second and 13, they give it to Alexander, and he can't go anywhere because Webster is there again. Back-to-back good plays by the cornerback.
You know, the defensive coaches always say you have to have a fit now, and you know, as you everyone has a gap, everyone has a hole. That time, Webster just fit right in that backside cutback.
See how the 49ers have progressed defensively, and it goes back to using their top choices for defense as they've rebuilt this team after they were in salary cap hell following the 99 season.
This is one here where the, you know, you better get pretty good pass protection here because you have to take a shot here to go for the end zone.
Third and 11, they fake it to Alexander. And Alexander is the intended receiver, and he can't handle that one. And they'll have to settle for what they hope is a game-tying field goal.
Yeah, you needed protection in this situation. Here's one of the best tackles in football, Walter Jones. And you just watch him on Andre Carter. He's just too big and too strong for him. And if Jones gets into you like he does and gets his hands, he has great feet. And there's no way that Andre Carter, if he doesn't beat him in that first move, no way he's going to beat him.
Ryan Lindell from 36, and he hooked it. No good. They can't tie it. 8:19 to the half. 49ers up by three. Seattle, Al Michaels, John Madden, and Melissa Stark. 49ers on top, 10-7 after the missed Lindell field goal. The ball is at the 26-yard line now as the 49ers take over. Split backs. Give it to Barlow. And Barlow with a flag down to the 40-yard line. So they split Barlow and Hurst in the backfield. Good play, but it was a good play because there was a hole.
You know, the left guard, though, the rookie Eric Heitman made a nice block, and that's the hole that Barlow went through. I don't know that he was a guy that held, though, but it was, from up here, it was a good
holding
block.
Number 62, offense. 10-yard penalty, repeat first down.
Jerry Newberry
lines right next to Heitman. Here's Heitman, though. Watch his block. Here's Newberry. He's the guy that they catch for holding. Where you see there, they start to see the job that Heitman did. He just turned that guy out. I don't know where Newberry held. Oh, right there he held. He has Chad Eaton's left arm, right arm with his left arm.
So instead of a first down for the Niners, it's a first down, all right, but first and 20 back at their own 16. Owens in motion. Owens takes the toss. Owens gets a block out past the 20-yard line. And Terrell up to the 26-yard line. James Jordan through the block. It's back to just about the original line of scrimmage. It'll be second down and 10.
Yeah, the 49ers are something. We're talking about these receivers all looking the same. James Jordan is a guy that they just activated for this game off their practice squad. And you look at him and his body and stuff, he looks just like the other guy. And they bring him in. He's the guy that was doing that block in there.
Well, there goes Zach Bronson off. We'll check on his condition. Bronson had the interception that led to a touchdown. So the 49ers safety goes back to the locker room, limping. Second down and 10 now from the 26. And breaking up the play in the backfield, Anton Palapoy, a rookie out of Nevada Vegas. No game, maybe a loss of one. First time that Monday Night Football has been back in Seattle since 1992. I'm very happy. 92 is the last time. George Hill, our longtime statistician, lives in Port Angeles, Washington. Talk about traveling the games through the years. He finally gets a home game.
So George, for 10 years, has been on the road on Monday night. This is your first home game?
Since 1992 for George. Yep.
Someone sent up a cake because of that.
Yeah.
We have a cake up here in the booth that someone sent for George's homecoming, I think.
Four Seasons cake. Third down and 12 from the 24-yard line. Play clock is down to zero. And the whistle blew, but nobody could hear it because of the crowd. That'll cost them five.
Delay a game. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
You know, it's interesting how the 49ers did so well offensively while they were in that script. And then once they got out of that script, they've gone to mediocrity, and they look like the script had them in some kind of sink, and then they've gotten out of that sink.
Like the writer went on strike, 19 plays, and he said, you're not paying me enough.
Right, and now all they have is a typist.
Yeah. Budget cuts. Can't afford the writer anymore. Third down and 17. And that's knocked down. Terrell Owens, the intended receiver. Good defensive work by the Seahawks, and so that holding penalty was costly. Niners are three and out and punt.
Yeah, I think Terrell Owens sneaked a peek on that one. You know, and part of it is you're coming in there and you know you're going to get hit, so you have to take it anyway, but you want to control the ball and get the ball before you take the hit. It looks like he started to get the ball, forgot about the ball to take the hit.
Jason Baker, he'll do the punting. Bobby Engram runs up to field it at the 40-yard line. Breaks a tackle at the 43, gets into Niner territory, and off he goes. Bobby Engram with no flag, 61 yards. Brian Jennings was the snapper. He was the guy who got downfield. He couldn't tackle him, and the Seahawks take the lead.
Bobby Engram comes up big on that one. And we know what he's done as a wide receiver in the slot. But here he gets the ball. The big thing is he takes it on the run. The bad thing for the 49ers is they had three of them all bunched in there. That meant that they left their lanes, and once he could cut back and get that lane, he saw that end zone. Bobby Engram doesn't have a lot of speed, but he sure looked like he had some speed on that play.
Ryan Lindell for the point after. Engram was the Bears' punt returner as a rookie in 96, and then he didn't return punts for a number of seasons. Now he comes back as the Seahawk punt returner, makes two big third down plays earlier, and a touchdown here. Hawks have the lead.
Taking time for me.
Shouldn't you be at the office?
No, I'm smelling the roses.
Wait a minute. Where'd you go for lunch?
There's something so delicious about Wendy's Mozzarella Chicken Supreme with a whole breast filet mozzarella and parmesan sauce.
How was it?
Uplifting.
It takes you and chicken to a higher level.
Good. Now get back to work.
Wendy's Mozzarella Chicken Supreme. It's better here. And our pickup window's open till midnight or later, so you can eat great even late.
Possibly one. I thought that we
Blue, a new fusion of berry and cola. Pepsi Blue, it's the mix.
Funny how a dad will bend the rules when his daughter dates Terry Bradshaw's son.
It's a school night.
Oh, she doesn't study. Go have a good time.
Catch the hit comedy Eight Simple Rules Tuesday on ABC.
Aerial coverage tonight being provided by Southwest Airlines. Bobby Engram with the run back, 61 yards.
Yeah, we talked about Bobby Engram not having speed. To test of that, if you get out in front and you look back, that means that you don't think you have speed. Bobby Engram got out in front and looked back four times on that play.
He looked like a jockey on a horse that's running out of gas. Where's the wire? Cedric Wilson up to the 30-yard line. Had the lead at the eighth ball, had the lead at the 16th ball, and holds on. 14-10, Seahawks. Son of sports legend, Terry Bradshaw, guest starring tomorrow night. Here's Garcia on first down, and the pass is caught by Ty Streets inbounds at about the 36-yard line. What a play.
And that's the guy they're going to work on. They're going to work on Ken Lucas over there. We know that if it's going to be Terrell Owens, it's going to be crosses and other type of things. If you're just going to go up, it's going to be on Ken Lucas. You see Ty Streets, he gets the step. The two there, and then he puts his left hand back there to make sure that he maintains that step or two.
From the 35, pump faking is Garcia, then he rifles one into double coverage, intended again for Streets. So he calls Ty's number again, and that's incomplete. And Lucas and Marcus Robertson recovering on the play.
I think they come in with a game plan, knowing that, you know, that all the coverages are going to go through to Terrell Owens, so they want to play Ty Streets out there. And if you're going to roll your coverages, if you're going to do everything to Terrell Owens, then when we're going to go deeper, look for the big one, we'll go to Ty Streets.
Hurst and Barlow are both in the game again. Occasionally you'll see them in a split back formation. This time they come up in the eye, or at least start out that way. Then they leave Barlow in the backfield and send Hurst wide left. Second down and 10. Blitz, pressure, dumped off. Marcus Bell that time came crashing through, third-year backer out of Arizona.
Yeah, we were talking to Chad Brown the other day, and Chad Brown is a heck of a linebacker. And then on third down, and this situation is coming up, he becomes a pass rusher. And he says what he does is he gets outside and he looks in at the hands. He looks in at Jeff Garcia's finger. So instead of moving on the ball, you see the fingers move first. So what he's doing is not keying the ball. He's looking in and keying Jeff Garcia's hands and fingers.
Third and 10. The Niners have gained two more yards than Seattle. Each team has run 26 plays. It's that even. And then Garcia takes off. And with a big third down run, picks up a first down at the 16-yard line.
And we showed earlier how Jeff Garcia moves in that pocket. He usually finds that hole, and that hole will be with that end getting up the field, and then you pin the tackles, and he'll usually run and throw in that hole. But watch him here. You see, he sees this gap here. He usually steps up and throws the ball in that gap, but he saw that he had a step and could get a first down, so he took it.
Reminiscent of what Steve Young used to do on a third and 10, running for 17. First and 10 now at the 18-yard line. Niners trailing by four. Garcia stepping up again, taking off again, getting inside the 10, and then a run out of bounds, but not until he picks up a first down.
And I'll tell you, this Seattle Seahawks defensive line had better stay in their lanes now, because this is Jeff Garcia picking them apart here, but they're giving him these lanes to run in. Well, just watch. The last time they gave him a lane on the left. Now, look at this lane right here. It's wide. I mean, he has from here to here to run in. Kazavinsky has to make that tackle, though. And there's Eric Johnson picking off Kazavinsky. That's a Yale player blocking a Harvard player.
Hurst and Barlow have combined for 15 yards on seven carries, but Garcia with a flag thrown here and no play. Garcia is the guy who's burned them for 29 yards on two carries.
Prior to the snap, false start. Number 65, Muffet. 5-yard penalty.
That's Ron Stone, the free agent, longtime Giant, picked up in the offseason.
Yeah, you know, they lost Ray Brown, and then they picked up Ron Stone, so that was kind of their trade there. They got another good guard for a good guard, but they got a little younger. This is tough here. You know, when they get down here in the red zone, this crowd is tough here because they're very close. And so when the 49ers, the closer they get, the closer they're getting to the stands.
Niners, second best in the league last year inside the 20. But this year, problems. Garcia moving to his right, and that'll be a minimal gain caught by Beasley at the 10. Tackled by Kazavensky.
Yeah, he was trying to get the ball to Terrell Owens here, and Terrell Owens is a good player. Sean Springs is also a good player, and this is a heck of a matchup. And you see Sean Springs has him here. He starts in. Sean Springs is all over him, and Terrell Owens just kind of slowed up. But that was where Jeff Garcia tried to go to first.
Second and goal. Barlow is the running back. Four receivers in this formation. Pressure, look out, Chad Brown.
Ooh, Chad Brown better look out. Tough's enough. We saw Chad Brown on the other side looking in. We're saying what he's keying. He's keying Jeff Garcia's fingers, and that's to get him off before the ball is snapped. Everyone else is watching the ball. He's trying to watch Jeff Garcia's fingers, and I'll tell you, he comes blasting out of here on this one. Before, we saw him on the right side all the time. That time he was on the left defensive side. Watch him. No one blocks him, and he just zeroes in on Garcia. It was Garcia's onside, but he was looking to the left. Therefore, it became his backside.
Fourth straight game with a sack for Chad Brown. Brown roaring, third and goal. Garcia under pressure. Looks to take off again and gets run out of bounds at the 12 and slung down by Reggie Tung.
Yeah, they knew that. You know, they talked about Jeff Garcia running on him. He ran two or three times, and I'm sure that in that huddle they were saying, we've had enough of this guy, let's get after him. And they are getting after him, but Jeff Garcia is very, very accurate, and he's a heck of a thrower and a heck of a quarterback, but more than any of those things, he's a tough guy.
29-yard attempt coming up for Jose Cortez. And that one is inside the left upright just before the two-minute warning as the Niners climb to within one. 14-13 Seattle. Tiger Woods among those in action this Sunday here on ABC, the Disney Golf Classic from Walt Disney World. Rich Beam also, the Davis Love, Jim Furyk, all expected to compete. Final round coverage Sunday right here on ABC. Cortez's kickoff fielded 9-yard line by Maurice Morris. And they take him down at the 22-yard line. Still a few ticks before the two-minute warning. And as usual, Terrell Owens gets exorcised when he's not in the play.
Well, you're going to see him. He's going to come across here. He's right here coming in motion, and he's running and out and up. And he thought right there that he should have been throwing the ball. And he probably had, you know, I mean, he probably had a legitimate complaint, but you have to realize that Jeff Garcia was under a lot of duress. I mean, he could have thrown that ball to the second pylon, but there was a heck of a lot of stuff going around Jeff Garcia.
And he comes off the field, and I think he's yelling at Greg Knapp, the offensive coordinator. And that is caught by Bobby Engram. What a night the former Bear is having. Bobby Engram has now caught three for 41 yards, run a punt back for a touchdown as we come to the two-minute warning and the Hawks have the lead. Lex's halftime show, 7 days to Monday night. We followed Garrison Hurst around all week, and we'll take a look at his week. Seven days to Monday night. And we'll see how Garrison Hurst prepared for tonight's game, in which the 49ers are trailing by a point, and a whistle sounds before the snap. Bill Levy, second-year referee, I mentioned before, first Monday night game for him.
Prior to the snap, false start, number 82, offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Darryl Jackson. While we're away, while we're in commercial,
Steve Mariucci talking there to Terrell Owens. And, you know, part of it, I mean, Terrell has to understand, I'm not sure what Steve is telling him, but, you know, maybe you were open, but where was the quarterback? I mean, Jeff Garcia was running for his life and scrambling to the left, and that pattern that he was running was to the right side.
First and 15, Bilford throws, caught by Darryl Jackson, and he's up to the 45, and that's a first down. Seahawks have all of their timeouts. That's a 16-yard gain, and they'll go without a huddle here, conserving all of the timeouts.
Can't you just feel Trent Dilfer's confidence rising?
Absolutely. He's 10 out of 16 for 108 yards, and it stays on the rise as Darryl Jackson makes the catch a little short of the first down at the 46-yard line, and he'll spend his first timeout with 90 seconds left right here. You know, John, when you were coaching, did receivers act like, I can't remember back that far, but I mean, we see it with Keyshawn Johnson. We see it with a lot of receivers, a lot of very good receivers. They can never get the ball enough.
No, and I think there's a fine line between being a competitor. You know, being a competitor to wanting the ball, give me the ball and I'll win the game for us, and being selfish. And I think that, you know, sometimes if you just want the ball for statistics, I think you're selfish. If you want the ball to win the game for you, then that's being a competitor. I mean, Larry Bird was that way. Michael Jordan, you know, give me the ball and I'll win the game for you. And I think part of Terrell Owens is that. I mean, give him the ball and he can win the game for you. But sometimes it's the old thing. You'd like to say to the guy, okay, change places. You go right. Play quarterback and let me play wide receiver. Then you'll see what I'm going through. Then you'll know why I couldn't throw you that ball.
Not to think of the coach. Second down and one. Alexander with a carry up or down to the 43-yard line. Clock ticking, conserving their timeout. Still have a pair. Dilford steps up to avoid the pressure and then hits the tight end, and that is Itula Mili. And he's out of bounds to stop the clock. They'll spot him at the 36, a little short of the first down. Quickly, an update from Melissa.
A number of injuries for the 49ers. Running back Terry Johnson, he tore his right ACL. Terry Jackson, excuse me, tore his right ACL. Free safety Zach Bronson, who had interception earlier tonight, he broke his left foot. They are both obviously out for the rest of the game, and who knows how much longer. Defensive end John Engelberger, they did x-rays on his ankle. His right ankle, he has a high ankle sprain. His return is doubtful.
And while you're speaking, Melissa, there's Julian Peterson, who is shaken up, another 49er, the linebacker, and he needs some assistant. And with Bronson now out, Ronnie Hurd, who has been hurt as well and was on the list this week, is questionable. He will have to spell Bronson and see maybe more action than Mariucci wanted him to see.
Right, because last night when we talked to Steve Mariucci, he wasn't even sure if Ronnie Hurd could play tonight. And now Ronnie Hurd's going to have to play tonight.
Because of that injury, you don't get a free injury timeout. It's inside 2 minutes. So that costs the 49ers a timeout. Second down and three now at the 35-yard line. And a whistle again as Dilfer was going over the middle, been living over the middle tonight.
Prior to the snap, false start. Number 77, offense. 5-yard penalty, second down.
Floyd Womack.
That's old Pork Chuck.
Yeah.
Pork Chuck Womack over there on that right side. Big 330, 340-pound tackle. And next to him is Floyd Wedderburn, and he weighs about 330 or 340. So that right side of the Seahawk offensive line is pretty doggone big. But look at Womack. He has a cast on that left hand, and he's not going to hold anyone with his left hand.
And it's with Seahawk blue as well. And here's Alexander, no room to roam to the right, trying to go back to the left, and Andre Carter led the charge.
Yeah, and that's the thing as a runner that you can't do. I mean, you have to, they weren't in field goal position. So when you get down there in second down, the first goal you have, get in field goal position and then go for the score. So now when you lose yardage, now they got third and long to get in position to kick a field goal.
Ball's back at the 47, they have to get to the 33. Half a minute to go. Third and 15. With Ingram in motion. fake screen, come back the other way. Here goes Ingram again inside the 40, and he'll get them into field goal range. Long field goal range, but at least they'll be able to attempt it. And he also picks up the first down as he gets out of bounds at the 32.
And I think that will give the Seahawks another shot at it. I don't think they have to kick the field goal yet, because now they get the first down. They still have two timeouts. This is a situation where, you know, what do you do here? It's a long field goal, so do you take your shot at the end zone and try and get the touchdown and then try a long field goal? Or do you try and get 10 more yards to get in a comfortable field goal range?
I try to get 10 more yards. Seattle takes a timeout. They have one left. Monday Night Football is being brought to you by Southwest Airlines, proud sponsor of the NFL and official airline of Super Bowl 37. Nissan and your Nissan dealer. Coors Light, the official beer sponsor of the NFL. Cold down easy. And Lowe's Home Improvement Warehouse. Lowe's improving home improvement. What a shot. Downtown Seattle. Maybe they want us to go to Montana.
I'll tell you, this place, this Seattle, though, we talked about it earlier, the beauty of, you know, not only the stadium, but the surrounding area, the city, the weather, and it sounds like a Chamber of Commerce deal, but these have been Chamber of Commerce days here.
Unbelievable. I mean, when you drive into this town and you look at those two stadiums and the skyline and the Space Needle, phenomenal. First and 10 from the 32. And the receiver got held or pushed. Corin Robinson got knocked down, and thus the flag.
Yeah, and that's where Trent Dilfer was throwing, too. He was throwing to Corin Robinson. When he came ready to deliver the ball, Corin Robinson was on the ground.
Illegal contact foul. Number 24, defense. 5-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
First round pick, Mike Rumpf, rookie from Miami.
And he is on Corin Robinson. And you see Rumpf come here. See, you get out of position, and he hits him there. He gives him a shot. Now, if that were within the first 5 yards, that would be legal. Once he passes beyond 5 yards, then you can't bump him. Rumpf bumped after five.
First Hurricane drafted by the 49ers since the late 80s. First and 10. So right now, they don't gain another yard. They are looking at about a 45-yard field goal attempt. Still with one timeout left from the 27. Pressure from the outside, and now Dilfer is able to escape. A little toss, it's a live football, and that's going to take them pretty much out of field goal range. Alexander. Rashad Holman came in from the corner, was going to sack him, and to get rid of the ball and try to get them back into field goal range, they work themselves out of field goal range.
Yeah, and he knows this, and you want to get rid of the ball. If you can't get rid of the ball right there, but you don't want to get rid of it backwards. You can't do that. That was a stupid thing, and Trent Dilfer will be the first one to tell you that was stupid. If you can't get rid of it, if you can't get the ball out of there, then just take the sack. But you cannot lateral like that.
Seahawk plug record field goal is 55 yards by John Casey a few years back. This one will be kicked from about the 47. That's going to make it a 57-yard attempt. Matt Hasselbeck would put it down. I wonder if they try to fake here.
That would be a lot better than trying a field goal here.
You would think. And that kick is no good. And Chris McAllister is probably sitting there in Baltimore saying, you know what, I'd have been back there and I'd have run that back 107 yards.
I was thinking the same thing. If they're going to try that long one, why not put a guy back there? Because a couple of Monday nights ago, it worked pretty well.
Longest play in the history of the league. Lexus Halftime Show, 7 days to Monday night. We follow Garrett and Hurst, and we'll count down to the 500th game of Monday Night Football. After this message from the NFL and a word from our ABC stations. Back in Seattle, the 49ers jumped out to a 10-0 lead, but back came the Seahawks, and they lead by a score of 14-13 at halftime.
Well, after the 98 season, Garrison Hurst in the playoffs suffered an ankle injury. He'd had a scintillating start to his San Francisco career, and then he suffered an injury, and it looked like it would be career-ending. Underwent 5 operations, but made a miraculous comeback. Had a tremendous year last year. Not much of a factor tonight, but what a story he has been. And tonight, he's the subject of our feature. Garrison Hurst, 7 days to Monday night.
I'm just G, old country boy to play football. I didn't like to play because it never worked. But since we've ran it this season, it's worked every time.
Cuts outside, Ty Streeter blocks him into the end zone. Touchdown, 49.
When you win, the coaches are smiling. Monday come, you walk different. You're sore, but you're not as sore. Nothing hurts as much after you win. The food tastes better. Monday's an easy day for us. After the weights, after the meetings, go home and wait for the game to come home.
Brett Favre,
Southern Mississippi.
Brett Favre.
You know, we're sitting here watching a game on Monday night, and next week we'll be the team that's being watched. That's a dream. Just enjoy it. On Tuesday, my day is no football. I can't hit the ball.
Nobody see that, did they? Stay right there, I don't need it. Oh, y'all got that. God.
You're still a little sore from Sunday. You got to fight through the first part of practice. We're trying to get everything executed so we know which ones look good for Monday. That's when we start thinking about the next team. It has to be Seattle.
John Randall back. Sean Spring. Chad Brown. I'm gonna need some fresh legs just to run with him.
I'm a hot, cold tub guy. Cold tub, 15 minutes. Hot tub, 5 minutes. Cold tub, 10 minutes. Hot tub, 5 minutes.
Hey, dawg, let me get some ice.
Hey, somebody said they wanted some more ice.
No. I'm going to turn it off.
Every now and then, we crack a few jokes.
Hey, can I hold a camera, man? Let me see the camera.
Thursdays are pretty long.
You got to understand who we got over there. We got Chad Brown on the left side, most likely over Derek. And then you got the big guy sitting inside who's coming back, Randall. We want to help inside on that look there.
If we have food for lunch, make a plate there and take it home, which so you don't have to cook. That's a veteran move. Thursday, I'm coming home and sitting around the house, call the family.
I can't see you.
I don't see you yet. It's coming
I can't
in.
See you.
There you go.
I can't.
Okay.
I'm still a mama's boy. I love my mama.
What do you think of this Seahawk defense?
They got Chad Brown, who plays linebacker and DN. And we're going to be checking him the whole night. A lot of times we get rid of running routes, they'll tell us to check, check. That's one person you got to look out for.
When I come out before the kickoff, that's when I'm into it. Here I am. It's time. Everybody's watching this. My hometown, everybody don't have cable. Everybody can get ABC, so I know people gonna see me.
7 days to Monday night with Garrison Hurst, who's had some big Monday night games. Speaking of Monday night, we'll look at two of the greatest games ever when we come back. Seahawks Stadium in Seattle. Al Michaels, John Madden, Melissa Stark as we get set to start the second half. Good first half, 1-point lead for the Seahawks, who erased a 10-point deficit. Mike Holmgren, now in his fourth season here, left Green Bay, got all the autonomy he wanted, got a phenomenal contract, got his team into the playoffs that first year, but out they went, missed the playoffs the last two. This is really a very telling season, all things considered, John, for Seattle.
I think it's going to be very telling. I think it's going to be very telling for Mike Holmgren. I mean, do you see Mike Holmgren here 3 years from now?
Not unless they have a lot of success. Kickoff comes to the 4-yard line. Maurice Morris takes it there, the rookie out of Oregon. Back up to the 26-yard line. Well, the Niners dominated the first part of the first quarter, and then the Seahawks got back into it, have the lead, and in terms of the statistics, fairly even.
Yeah, I think the big thing there, the Seahawks came into this game and they hadn't been able to handle or stop the run, and I think they did a very good job in that first half.
And that's been the bugaboo for them. But they got Randall back. Good defensive scheme tonight. Steve Sidwell putting it in for the game. And it's been very successful. Dilfer throws. That pass is incomplete. Robinson looking around for a flag. Then there is a flag thrown, but late. Jeff Ulbrich with the coverage on the play. Did he trip him?
Pass interference. Number 32, defense. Automatic first down.
Number 32. Well, 32 is Kevin Barlow. It wasn't him, trust me.
You know, we were talking about the first half and Trent Dilfer and how he was working this middle of the field most of the time to Engram. You see, he only went deep once to the left. He completed one to the left, twice in the middle, only once to the right side, incomplete. And all his stuff has been right, left, and middle underneath 15 yards, with most of it being in the middle of the field.
And he'll work against that depleted secondary. Robinson broke his foot in the first half, and this is Alexander swarmed under at the 30, and let's check in with Melissa.
Well, Mike Holmgren said the plan coming into this game, if the 49ers defense was going to allow them to throw the ball, they were going to take advantage of that. But the plan in the second half is to get the ball more to Sean Alexander. As far as that backward pass at the end of the first half, he said it was terrible. It was ugly. It was horrible. But his main message at halftime, you know what? We're ahead. Let's just keep the lead.
It was ugly. Took him out of field goal range. Second down and 11. Here comes the blitz. Dilfer hangs in there, throws, catches made at the 35 by Darryl Jackson, and he's close to a first down, tackled at the 40 by Ronnie Hurd.
Yeah, it's that middle again. The Seahawks have really found something here in this 49er defense. You know, they're not having a lot of success deep, but they are finding right here with a good pocket like this, just working that middle against these 49er zones.
Third down, short one from the 41. Against the four-man front. And against that front, they give it to Alexander, and he bursts through it and picks up a first down and gets into 49er territory to the 49er 49.
And that was one that the 49er defense really loaded up for the run. They had nine guys up there, but the Seahawks ran it anyway, and Alexander gets right through it. They're lined up here. Good takeoff on that left side. We were talking earlier about Walter Jones, the left tackle. He's superb. Watch 71 there. See, he starts to clear the way. I mean, he really collapses that left side.
Alexander. Seahawks tonight, John, 7 out of 9 on third down, including a couple of key passes to Engram on that first touchdown drive. Alexander gets it there coming into the game. That had been their problem, converting on third downs.
Yeah, and they were in a lot of third and long situations. And usually, to get yourself in a third and long situation, you usually had some, what did Mike Holmgren call them, ugly plays on first and second down to put you in that situation. They're better on first and second down tonight also.
Draw. And here comes a third down at about 5. Has any coach ever described a third and long as anything but ugly?
No, that's one that, you know, when the quarterback used to look over the side, that's one that, as a coach, you always had to go get a drink and say, you got yourself in this position, you get yourself out of it. But now that the coach calls the plays, Mike Holmgren calling the plays into Trent Dilfer, you have to kind of stand there and take every situation.
Third down and 5 from the 44. Dilfer, who won the job with his late season performance last year, throws over the middle, and that's tipped and incomplete. So over the middle again he went, intended for Darryl Jackson and off his hands. And that'll bring Jeff Fiegels in to punt.
You know, we said earlier that the Seattle Seahawks defense had to play well against the run. We looked at those halftime stats. The 49ers only ran for 52 yards. And the biggest part of that was Jeff Garcia running. I mean, the longest runs were both by the quarterbacks. Garcia, 17 yards, and Dilford, 13 yards.
Garcia, the leading ground gainer. Jeff Fiegels has been in the league since 88. Has it bounced at the one, and look at that. Max Strong gets down there to save it from going into the end zone. Perfectly placed punt by Fiegels. His first punt tonight is a beauty. And the Niners have backed up deep. Those are suites at ground level. They call them red zone suites here. And above that, the Hawks nest. And they're so close to the action, and they love this. Down a punt at the 1 yard line.
And this is when that end zone crowd, those are the up above there, those are the $20 seats, and that's their rendition of the dog pound.
Here's Beasley trying to give them some room. Second down and 9. Let's take a look at the 49ers start track right now. Garcia, good beginning, and then they were able to stymie him, and nothing doing really on the ground for the Niners, and Owens has that one touchdown catch.
Now, here's that dog pound shot that I was talking about, Al. That, look at that. It kind of looks like a ride, doesn't it? When you see the picture of that end zone, that crowd, it looks like something you'd ride.
I love it. It's the Hawks' nest. And now they buy a lot of room as Cedric Wilson comes close to getting the first down. I walked in a way it reminds you of Wrigley Field of the bleachers. It's actually in the shape of half a football. And it's just bench seating there. No backs. You sit on a bench. $20. What a sight.
Yeah, but it looks like you ought to slide down it or something. It ought to be a water slide. You know, you stand in line, buy a ticket, take a slide. Because it's steep, too. It goes straight up.
You saw Garcia was flexing his right leg as they measure here, and it is a first down.
Ooh, and that's a big first down, too, because that got him out away from that dog pond, got him out where if they have to punt, they have plenty of room for it. It was a big play.
Paul Allen is the chairman, the major domo of the Seattle Seahawks, who has made his fortune with Microsoft and looks on in this, I think it's the nicest facility I've seen.
He's a major domo of a lot of things.
A lot of stuff,
it?
Yes, he is.
He and Gates, I think they have all the money.
First and 10 from the 11, and that's caught by Terrell Owens. Tries to get the first down and is bounced out of bounds after a gain of 9 and wants a flag for a late hit.
I'll tell you one thing about Terrell Owens is he's a competitor and he's in the game. I mean, you know, some of the times, you know, he may be big, go overboard. You say he argues with the players, the coaches, but he is a fiery competitor. And I'll tell you, I would much rather have that
personal
than
foul.
The opposite.
Late hit out of bounds. Number 31, defense. 15-yard penalty from the dead ball spot. Automatic first down.
That's Marcus Robertson. He wanted the flag and he got it.
Yeah, he catches that ball and you're going to see him as he goes out of bounds right there. Robertson hits him. And he did. I mean, he was out of bounds. He's in the white now, and right there. Oh, that was really late.
Cochran first, and then Robertson comes in. Garcia now at the 35-yard line, first and 10. First, following Beasley. Up to the 42. Let's check in again with Melissa.
Well, Al, Terrell Owens, 3 catches, 32 yards, and a touchdown in the first half, and he was clearly upset. We saw it at the end of the second quarter. I asked Steve Mariucci about it, and frankly, he didn't want to talk about it. He said the plan is to always get the ball to Owens more. Now, on the defensive side, he is very concerned about the loss of safety Zach Bronson out with that broken foot. He said we're down to 3 safeties. Clearly puts pressure on their secondary, Al.
Yeah, that really hurts. As far as Owens is concerned, he's probably tired of talking about it. Second and 2 from the 43-yard line. And that's a first down for Garrison Hurst. Kazavensky making the hit. And we thank the folks over at Safeco Field. How great is that?
You know, if you had to play the position, would you like to be that? I would be the second baseman. you'd be the shortstop.
I'd be the shortstop. But who would be our manager? I mean, there's all kinds of speculation that Lou Piniella's not going to come back.
I don't think Lou Piniella's going to be here next year. Maybe we could, I mean, if you played shortstop and I play second base, we were turning that double play, I'll guarantee you he wouldn't come back.
Yeah, we wouldn't win 116 games, I know that. Here's Garrison Hurst. And he picks up a first down. He's out of bounds at the 41-yard line.
They talk about getting the ball to Terrell Owens, and, you know, that's always part of the game plan. And I think what Steve Mariucci was talking to Melissa about is you don't want it to be a distraction. But in addition to that, you also want to get the ball to Garrison Hurst. That's not a bad deal. Or to Kevin Barlow when he's in there. So it's not all about getting the ball to Terrell Owens. They have a number of playmakers on this team.
At the 40, first and 10. Seahawks up by a point. Barlow. Good burst. Big guy. Quick acceleration. Takes it to the 33-yard line.
This is good hitting in this game. You know, that I watched the Seattle Seahawks earlier, and I thought their defense wasn't very good, and I thought that one of the things is they didn't tackle well. But they really are tackling well now. I mean, they're a lot more solid in this game than I've seen them in their previous game. That's Ron Stone on John Randall there. He lifts him up and just turns him and takes him to the outside. Stone will do that most of the game to John Randall.
Second and a deuce. Nice move by Barlow. Nothing happening straight ahead. Cuts it to the outside, and this is a first down and a big-time drive here for San Francisco. Remember, this drive started at the one-yard line.
And again, Ron Stone does another good job on John Randall. You know, John Randall, you know, we talked about that earlier, that he's not a run guy anyway, and what he brings is the emotion and the passion here, but he's never been a big run stuffer. He plays that three technique, the outside shoulder of the guard, but he has a tough time when you run right at him. He has a tough time hanging in there.
28-yard line on first down. He sends Owens in motion. Looks like a fake to Owens. It is. Then he goes back to Owens inside the 30. And Owens to the 22-yard line. So Owens runs about 70 yards total to pick up six, maybe.
Yeah, but it's a catch. It's six, so it's all worth it. But that's the type of thing I think, you know, when they're going to lock up and they're going to give you coverage, you have to move them. And that's what they're doing here. They're bringing him motion. They're faking to him and then throwing to him on the other side. Now, Sean Springs is playing a man-to-man. And as you said, Terrell Owens had a run to 70 yards. So did Sean Springs.
Second down, four. From the 22, the fake to Beasley. Garcia has room inside the 20. First down, out of bounds. They'll mark it at the 15-yard line. Run out by Marcus Bell.
We talk about Terrell Owens being a competitor. This guy's a competitor here, too, this Jeff Garcia, because he had that bootleg, and it's an option, either run it or throw it, and he saw that marker out there where he could get the first down. You see, he's looking downfield, and then at that moment, he decides that he's going to go for it, but when he goes for it, he knows he's going to get a first down.
32-year-old Jeff Garcia played in Canada. Worked out for a lot of teams before the 49ers signed him. One of the teams was the Rams. Hurst. Great, tough, hard running. Down to the 5.5-yard line, a little short of the first, tackled by Marcus Robertson and friends.
You know, you get all that list of things that you didn't do in the first half that you have to get or you have to get back to. This is one of them. Let's get our running game going. Let's get Garrison Hurst going. Let's get Kevin Barlow going. And you talk about tough running. When you finish off a run like that, that's tough running.
Second and one. This season, only the Broncos against the Niners had a 99-yard scoring drive. Barlow, first down. Barlow, touchdown.
Barlow about three great moves on that short run. That was amazing. That's the old 1-2 punch. That's a little Garrison Hurst, a little Kevin Barlow, a little Garcia run. But I'll tell you, Kevin Barlow made three moves on that play. I mean, just watch him here. He's going to start, then he cuts back here, then he makes another cut back there, then he makes another cut right there, and then just powers it in. Well, he's a heck of a player. He really is. And he's just going to get better and better.
Cortez for the point after. That is a drive out of a clinic. Remember, Fiegel's punt was downed at the one. 12 plays, 99 yards. And the Niners have the lead again. Five and a half minutes to play in the third quarter. San Francisco leading by six after a 99-yard drive. Brilliant.
You see Kevin Barlow there, and before that you saw a group with a heck of a lot of pride, and that was his offensive lineman. You know, when they can do something like that, when you can take the ball off your own goal line and drive it all the way down, and they don't change, you know. Isn't it something how the defensive linemen, you know, keep it fresh, they go in, they go out, everyone else. That offensive line, they're the same guys all the way.
Sure. Hurst and Barlow can take their time, and it's interesting because Mariucci said last night, I'm going to alternate series with them. This time he alternates them within the series. Maurice Morris from the nine, taken down at the 24-yard line. That's where the Seahawks will begin this drive with 5 minutes and 23 seconds remaining in the third period. 6-point lead for San Francisco. This Saturday at 3:30 Eastern time, the primary game will be Ohio State, fourth ranked, against Wisconsin. Other action, Iowa State, Oklahoma, Washington, USC, Wake Forest, and Clemson. College football right here on ABC. Seattle now from the 24-yard line begins this drive. Sean Alexander breaking one. One guy to beat, and he's the guy who knocks him down. Ronnie Hurd was the last man between Alexander and the goal line.
You know, and that's what we were talking about earlier, that you know, running is tough in the first quarter. It's a little easier in the second quarter. It gets even easier in the third, and it's probably the easiest in the fourth quarter. And you can see right now, well, that was a heck of a block right there, but it's starting to get easier for the Seahawks right now. And that last drive was easier for the 49ers.
42 yards, taking it to the 34-yard line. 4:40 to go in the period. And first down, pump fake, draw. Alexander, nothing cooking that time. Gain of a yard, yard and a half. Alexander played his college football in Tuscaloosa. Fourth running back chosen in the 2000 draft, and he's the Crimson Tide's all-time leading ground gainer. He had that Sunday night game against the Raiders last year, 266 rushing yards, and of course 2 weeks ago on a Sunday night, 5 TDs all in the first half. Second and 8, and on a slant, that's Corin Robinson making the catch, and he takes it to the 24 on his first reception of the night. First down.
The Seahawks, sometimes you get the feeling they have to be jump-started. You know, the 49ers score early, and then they're kind of in the doldrums, then boom, they come back and score. Then the 49ers go score, they take the ball, and now the Seahawks get jump-started, they come back, okay, let's us get going. Always get the guy that has his shirt off. If you don't know who did it, it's always the guy without a shirt.
From the 23 on first down, here's Alexander. And he gets wrapped up at the 21-yard line. He's taken down there by Derek Smith, the middle linebacker.
The tough thing about Alexander, he never goes at one speed. So that time he looks slow. So then you start thinking he's slow, and then he'll go, boom, he'll go right by you. And, you know, he always changes his speeds and changes his directions and never lets a defense really zero in on how quick or how fast he is or when he's going to get to where he's going.
Like a pitcher mixing up his pitches. Fastball here, change up there, little curveball, second and 7. Dilfer flings it over the middle, and once again, that's Bobby Engram. Tremendous night for Engram. The catches, the key catches, are over the middle. However, there's a flag down here. Engram had that punt return for a touchdown before. We've got a hold, but it's against the defense, to the delight of this crowd.
Holding. Number 29, defense. Penalty is declined. First down.
And we talk about how they're working the inside. Watch Bobby Engram. He's right here. He's in the slot, and that's what he does best. He works from that position, and you're going to see he just runs up, finds the hole in that defense behind the linebackers, in front of the safeties, right in the middle of the field.
Ahmed Plummer with a hole, first and goal from the four, and they give it to Max Strong through the middle, and Strong takes it to the one.
And one of the things about this game, we have two good, tough fullbacks. Fred Beasley on the 49ers side and Max Strong on the Seahawks side.
And you also have a tight end here, Itula Mealy, who is the king of the one-yard touchdown reception. Eight career TDs, six of them from 1 yard, but not here. Second and goal. They're going to spread it out.
Probably spread it out and run, yeah.
And through the middle, but not getting there, is Alexander.
Yeah, because they miscounted the box. I mean, they had seven guys in the box because they covered the four guys. That's the idea that they had, is if they wanted to spread them out. Now watch when they see they have four here, five, six, seven. So they got seven in the box. That means that should have been a passing play because the 49er defense did guess right and did gang up on the run.
And now they shift coming in and out. The offense first. Here comes the defense. Third down and goal. Mealy is in the game. But with the play clock running down, Dilfer takes a timeout before this most critical of calls. Timeout Seattle with a 1:14 to play in the period. 49ers up by six. Third down and goal after the timeout with a 1:14, and they'll keep it on the ground, and into the end zone goes Sean Alexander for the touchdown. Max Strong led the way. Alexander scores, and with the extra point, the Hawks will have the lead again.
We were just talking about what a tough guy Max Strong was and what a good blocker he was. And you know, if you're going to run, and if you need that play, you're going to run it to your left because you're right behind Walter Jones. Here's Walter Jones, your tackle here, making his block. Here's Strong right here, going to make the lead right there. That's the play that got Alexander into the end zone.
Ryan Lindell for the 21st point. Hasselback holds. Ooh, I'll tell you what, he made it interesting, didn't he? Just good.
I hit a lot of golf balls that go like that.
That one just did get on the green. 21-20, Seattle. Monday Night Football is being brought to you by Bud Light for the great taste that won't fill you up and never lets you down. Make it a Bud Light. Verizon Wireless, we never stop working for you. Wendy's Mozzarella Chicken Supreme, it's chicken on a higher level. And the Mitsubishi Outlander, prepare for what's down the road. Are you in? Southwest Airlines providing the aerial coverage as you look into Seahawks Stadium on the south fringe of downtown Seattle. Seahawks up by one, kickoff taken by Cedric Wilson from the nine. Back to the 28-yard line. 49ers will take over at that spot. Sorry to have to report another shooting fatality in Falls Church, Virginia. That, of course, is in the Washington, D.C. area. Nightline will have a special report after your late local news. On the West Coast, out here, ABC News will have a special report following the game. San Francisco from their own 28-yard line. Kevin Barlow is the running back in this set. Streets comes in motion to the inside. He looks for Owens and then throws it behind him.
You know, Sean Springs is doing a pretty good job on Terrell Owens. And, you know, he's one of those guys that for a while was a top corner in football, and then he had some hamstring problems and then some other problems. But when you put the corners down, you know, the guys that cover well, Sean Springs is one of the better guys. Now, that was just a mix-up there between Jeff Garcia and Terrell Owens.
Well, Springs had a huge night the last time the Seahawks were on a Monday night game in Green Bay a couple of years ago. This is Kevin Barlow up to the 33-yard line.
You know, how come when we have the college football and we say who's going to play, we say Ohio State, but then when the players, like Sean Springs is from Ohio State, He calls it the Ohio State.
Yeah, I think they were all taught that as they work on Chad Eaton shaking up on the play. That's the official name of it, the Ohio State University.
The Ohio State University, right. Huh?
Terry Glenn used to say it, or still does say it. Meanwhile, in San Francisco, as a lot of you already know who are checking things out with us, the Giants advanced to the World Series against the Angels as they beat St. Louis in the fifth game of the National League Championship Series, 2-1. A run in the bottom of the ninth to win it in thrilling fashion. And the World Series back in San Francisco for the first time since 1989. And don't I remember that pretty
yes,
well?
Yes, you do remember that. And I remember what you did in that one because I was in the area and I was listening and watching every word you said.
Well, that was October 17th. We don't need one here either. They've had them up here, as you know. Earthquakes knocked down. John Randall is the guy. The pass was low to begin with.
And now John Randall's getting fired up. He took away the lane.
Well, speaking of the Angels in the World Series, Michael Eisner was down in Anaheim yesterday, the chairman and CEO of our company, and, of course, the Disney company owning the Angels. So for Michael yesterday, what a weekend. He accepts the American League trophy. He goes to his Mighty Ducks opener against the Red Wings last night, and then Monday Night Football.
That's what I was telling his son. He could just walk around and say, yeah, that's ours. Yeah, that's ours. Hey, that's ours. Yeah, this is ours.
That's fair caught by Ingram. Everything but a basketball team.
Yeah, they got ours all over the place.
Yeah. And for those of you just joining us, Niners started out hot tonight. Jeff Garcia hitting Terrell Owens for a touchdown. They had a 10-0 lead. But the Seahawks countered. Max Strong made that reception. Bobby Engram then with a very big punt return, breaking a tackle. 49ers retook the lead in the third quarter on a 99-yard drive, and then Seattle answered with its own 76-yard thrust. And now as the third quarter winds down, Alexander gets bottled up at the line of scrimmage or a little bit beyond, and that's going to take us all the way down to the end of the third quarter. Best Monday night game of the year, John.
I know,
we
this
finally
is great.
Got a good one.
We have a brand new stadium, a beautiful night, and two teams that are really playing their guts out here tonight.
Beautiful. Seattle by one, and Monday Night Football resumes after this from our ABC stations. Get ready to start the fourth quarter. Al Michaels with John Madden and Melissa Stark here in Seattle, ESPN with SportsCenter following the game. You can tune in there. And we start the fourth quarter here with Seattle at its own 32-yard line on second down and 9. And Trent Dilfer, under pressure, gets it off to Alexander before he goes down. Stiff arms his way past one guy, takes it to the 40-yard line, a little short of the first down. Remember, Seattle now in the NFC West, the restructured NFL. Right now, San Francisco with the lead. Arizona had a bye. They're 3-2. So if Seattle wins tonight, the Niners and the Cardinals would be tied, and Seattle would be just one game back, and then there are the Rams.
Isn't that something? It looked like the 49ers were really getting separation because you thought it's either going to be the Rams or the 49ers, and they're getting separation on the Rams, and then in jumped the Arizona Cardinals. And as you say, if the Seahawks win tonight, in jump the Seahawks.
And that's why we talked about it at the beginning, how important this is, a pivotal game for Seattle. Very. Dilfer takes off, and before he gets tackled by Julian Peterson, he moves the chains. First down.
Trent Dilfer is really having a gutsy performance tonight because we know that, you know, his knee isn't all the way back to normal. He's wearing a brace on that, and that's kind of cumbersome. But when he's had to make plays with his legs, he's made plays with them. And I think that play just before that one where he hung in there and held the ball in the rush and got it to Sean Alexander late, that was a tough, tough play.
Dilfer was hurt in preseason. For a moment, he thought his season was over. Three-yard gain here by Alexander. We were talking to Dilfer yesterday and to Mike Holmgren, and one of the doctors went out and told Mike Dilfer is done for the year. This was in August.
Right, and told Dilfer that he was done for the year, said that he had an MCL, and then it wasn't an MCL. There's a shot of it there. You see the right knee, and you see him grab it. At this point, with this look, he thought that he was out for the season.
Sure did. No question. He was out until the second week. He didn't start the opening game this year at Oakland. Matt Hasselbeck got the start there. Raiders won the game. Second down and seven from the 49-yard line. Slings it out here near side to Darryl Jackson. And he is tackled at the 50. And let's get an update from Melissa.
Well, Al, and talking about Trent Dilfer, this is the first time in his nine-year career that he has been loved by a community. The Seattle fans were literally chanting for him to be the starting quarterback this year. But he loves the support, but he's not unrealistic about it. He told me in Tampa, I didn't play well enough or consistently enough to get that kind of support. In Baltimore, of course, he was cast away after winning the Super Bowl. He called that special but all too short. And now he said, I'm mature enough to know that this acceptance is based on my performance and nothing else.
Yeah, I mean, the graph of his career, up and down and up and down. And on third down here, he slings it into traffic and hits his main man tonight, Ingram, for another third down conversion, a 12-yard gain, first down Seattle.
That has been amazing. I mean, Bobby Ingram in the same place. He comes in as a third wide receiver. He lines up here in the slot. He just works the inside and then goes right to the middle. And Trent Dilfer, you said zipped the ball in there. He really zipped that one in there. That looked like a Brett Favre type of throw.
Last week.
That wasn't in the air a heck of a long time.
Ingram had caught six passes in the four games this season prior to tonight. He has six here tonight. Alexander taking the ball to the 36-yard line.
Womack there, old pork chop. I mean, that's, you know, it's tough. It's tough playing tackle in this league and have to pass protect, especially when you get to a third down situation. They put a little speed over there on you. But when you have a club on your hand, I mean, look at that left hand. There's no way that he can use that hand. And then when you can't use your hand, you can't use your wrist, you really become a one-handed tackle. And I'll say this, under those circumstances, under any circumstances, Womack is playing very well tonight.
Hard to eat pork chops with that thing on. Second and seven, they have Maurice Morris in the game at running back along with Max Strong as they give Alexander a brief rest. He takes it to the 33-yard line.
Usually when you hand one to your fullback like that, you're trying to fool them. You know, you hope that they're keying on the tailback, they're thinking pass and those kind of things. The 49ers didn't go for the fool job. They were there right there waiting for him.
Now Alexander back in the game. Holmgren sending in the call. More and more coaches are now talking to the quarterbacks directly. When that situation was instituted a few years back, it was normally the second-string quarterback or the offensive coordinator or the quarterback's coach.
Mike Holmgren said he didn't think he was mature enough to do it until this year.
But a flag before the play clock had run out for a false start.
False start. Number 82. Offense, 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Yeah, that was Darryl Jackson. There's two people that should never be offside. That's a nose tackle because he lines up right on the ball, and a wide receiver because he has nothing going on. If he doesn't remember the count, all he has to do is look in and watch the ball being snapped. That time Darryl Jackson was just in the slot and he moved. That's one of those things you talk about, focus and concentration, and that's just no focus, no concentration.
He was anticipating the snap count. Third down and nine. Dilfer, that's knocked away, batted, and intercepted at the 31-yard line. Cheeky O'Keefer got a hand on it, and then it's picked off by Ahmed Plummer at the 31-yard line. So O'Keefer backs it. 49ers pick it. 10-11 to go in the fourth. Now the 49ers after the interception, and Owens drops it. He started to look upfield before he looked it into his hands. Incomplete, second and 10.
Yeah, that was a heck of a play on that interception by Cheeky O'Keefer right there. What he did is he got up the field. We're going to see him here. He's going to get up the field, and then he's going to come back to the inside. See him get up the field, then come back to the inside to take away the lane. You see the lane in there? Trent Dilfer had the lane. O'Keefer was up. He was beyond it. And then he just put that left arm, boom, right back in the lane and took it away from Dilfer.
Second and 10 from the 32-yard line. Hurst on that inside handoff. Cutting it back, taking it up to the 38-yard line. Eaton makes the tackle. It'll be third down and about four.
That was a good tackle by Chad Eaton, because it looked like if he doesn't make that play, Garrison Hurst is going to get a big run out of that. There's a big third down play now. This is a situation where you don't have run-pass option anymore. This is a passing situation, so you're going to get pass defense, and you're going to get pass rush.
He sends Owens wide to the left. Streets wide right. Owens comes back inside. Garcia, a shovel. Hurst. And Hurst is into Seahawk territory to the 46. How's that for improvisation?
That's Jeff Garcia. I mean, Jeff Garcia, you look at him and you think he's too small. He doesn't have a strong arm. But he just knows how to play the game. He knows how to play football. And he feels and he has a great awareness of things around him. I mean, watch this play here. He comes here. Now, he always does this. He jumps up in the pocket, and then he sees something. He can throw it right-handed, left-handed, underhand, sidearm. That was kind of a sidearm lob job.
Sidearm backhand.
A loaf of bread coming out of there.
First and 10 from the 46. 8:40 to go in the fourth. Hurst on the ground again. And Hurst taking it to the 41-yard line. And Garrison Hurst tonight, 10 carries, 42 yards. Next week, Tony Dungy doing a nice job in Indianapolis. They come off their win yesterday. 4-1. Indy into Heinz Field to take on the Pittsburgh Steelers, trying to get it back together. They beat Cincinnati yesterday. Monday Night Football from Pittsburgh next week.
Indianapolis is always a fun team to watch. I mean, Peyton Manning, you know, is a real deal and is going to be more of the real deal. Edgerrin James, Marvin Harrison.
Harrison's big day yesterday. Second and 6, and that's batted and incomplete. He tried to flip it out to Streets. Looked like Chad Brown got a hand on it.
And it was Chad Brown that got the hand on it. And you're going to see he's coming. He's coming from the right side. And that's what all pass rushers do, is you rush a passer, but when he puts his hand up there, stop rushing and get your hands up. And we're talking about guys that are really good players. Chad Brown fits into that category. Look at his hands, man.
He's been a big Monday night player through the years, too. Third down and 6. Here they come. Garcia gets it away, lofts it up, flag is thrown. Owen stopped on the play. Sean Springs with the coverage. Flag down to the 27-yard line against Seattle.
And now we have two things. It could be.
Illegal contact foul. Number 24, defense. 5-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
Yeah, that's the one thing that could be, is if it's before the ball's in the air, then it's going to be a 5-yard penalty, automatic first down. If the ball were in the air, then it would be pass interference, and they'd get the ball at that spot. You saw it was right there where he did that jam, so they had to figure it was over 5 yards. I mean, Sean Springs is really playing well on Terrell Owens. He really is.
First and 10, ball at the 37-yard line. Split back, set. Garcia going deep. Owens on this side, just makes the catch, touchdown. So Owens on the last play on the other side, on this play comes to the left side, 37 yards, a tremendous adjustment on the play, and the Niners have the lead again.
Yeah, and that's why you know you have Terrell Owens there and you have to get him the ball, because it's plays like this. Springs that time didn't get his hands on him because he'd just gotten a penalty. He tried to get the hands there, and Terrell Owens just waits and waits and then makes the perfect jump. Now, if you have a guy like him on your team, it's like a Randy Moss, you have to get the ball to Terrell Owens.
And the 49ers now with a 5-point lead will go for 2, is what you do in this circumstance. Try to make it a 7-point lead. What is that a pin?
Yeah, he had a pin in his sock. And he pulled it out and autographed the ball.
That's a first. Who would even think of that? Here's Garcia, and that's caught by Hurst for the two-point conversion. No signature.
Who would think of that? Terrell Owens would think of that.
John Hancock lives. And the Niners have the lead again. So the 49ers with a touchdown, a two-point conversion, and a seven-point lead in a seesaw game in which the Niners once led by 10. Hawks led at the half. Owens scores. Terrell tonight, six catches, 84 yards. And the 49ers have cashed in after both Dilfer interceptions. Cortez's kick, short. 16-yard line, Maurice Morris, the Oregon rookie, brings it back out to the 35-yard line. Tackle there by Holman. 7:40 left in the fourth in Seattle. Seahawks down by a touchdown. Seahawks Stadium in Seattle. It's just phenomenal. It's a breathtaking facility. They did a masterful job. I think they got everything right at this place.
I would rather have grass field.
The one thing. That's caught by Corin Robinson up to the 50. This is that kind of hybrid stuff. It's soft. It feels like grass, but you don't water it.
And the players like it. I know that. The Seattle players like it. It's one of those things that is not as good as grass, but better than artificial turf. And you can see it's phony grass, and it has black rubber in there, like from tires.
Right.
So sometimes when a player goes down, you see that black stuff come flying out. That's tire rubber.
This is Alexander. And one reason they did that, of course, is because it rains here so much, it would be too difficult to maintain the field, make it look beautiful. The other thing they did here, and Alexander now comes hobbling off after that play. So Maurice Morris, the Oregon rookie, comes in. But to me, the one thing they did with this place that's perfect, they didn't make it luxury box dominant.
No, they didn't. I mean, this is for fans, and then they have those $20 seats and the bleachers, and this is a special place.
Second and 9. Webster was the guy who made the tackle, forcing Alexander out of the game for the moment. And what a play by Mike Runk, but it's an illegal play. He had an arm on him. He knocked it away, but he had his arm around Darryl Jackson.
That's right stuff to be a coach. People say, Terrell Owens, how do you put up with what he does? Well, he just showed you why you put up with what he does. And then you think you have things under control, and you're going to see Rump. That's very close. That first one was a jam. That was legal. And it's that second one in there just before the ball gets there. So Mike Rumpf has had a couple on him tonight, but they've been very, very close.
Moves it to the 37-yard line. It's a first down for the Seahawks. Morris is still in the game. Alexander on the sideline. Dilfer chased, hit from behind as he throws it away. Let's check in with Melissa.
Well, I just talked to the lucky recipient of the autographed ball from Terrell Owens. Interestingly enough, he's sitting in Sean Springs' suite, which makes it even more unbelievable. But they're friends. They do some business together. And earlier today, he said, listen, if you score a touchdown, I want the ball. And Terrell said, well, where are you sitting? He pointed it out. He said, all right, I'll keep a pen in my sock.
And then he scores a touchdown in front of the guy. I mean, how did he know he on the play before he's on the other side of the field, or he could have gone the other way?
Right. That's why he's Terrell Owens,
I guess.
That's what he thinks.
Second and 10. And that's caught by Itula Mealy, but a flag comes in at the end of the play.
I'll tell you, that flag came in from the deep official who is usually watching the tight end. So that's either going to be on the tight end or against the tight end, who was Mealy.
Pass interference, number 89. Offense, 10-yard penalty. Repeat second down.
Anytime you see that deep official throw that flag deep, it's either going to be on the tight end one way or another. Either someone holding the tight end or the tight end holding someone. Watch Mealy here. They said he pushed off. Oh, I don't know about that. You know, it's one of those things, a guy has position and he runs into him. I don't know. I mean, that
yeah.
To me, I mean, you could probably, but that to me is football. I mean, and the guy that calls it, now you have to realize he's like 25 yards behind that. He's not right there.
Second down and 20 from the 47. Alexander is back in the game. He gets it on the screen. Touch to the outside. He's taken down at about the 44-yard line. And it's going to be third down and long. But we talked about it at the outset, how important this game is for Seattle. And now it almost becomes doubly important to try to come from behind, win this game, and that would be the all-time boost for this team right now.
Yeah, and you had the feeling, you know, and just talking to players and watching them practice and so on, that they knew how important this was, and they were going to play well. And they really are. I think both teams are playing great tonight. I think both teams are playing under the circumstances as well as they can.
Third down and 17 from the 44. Guilford, deep drop, throws into traffic, and it's a low throw. Darryl Jackson had found an open spot, and Dilfer said, oh, man, I can't believe it.
Because Dilfer had the spot, too. I mean, you know, you're looking for the guy that's open, then you have to have a lane to throw it in. And Dilfer had both of those things. See, he looks, he sees it, and he has a lane to throw it in. And, boy, you just live and die with inches, don't you?
Throw him a sinker. Jeff Fiegel's to punt. Angles the kick, flag is down, and Fiegel's almost drops that one inside the five. It goes into the end zone. Flag on a fourth and 17 for a hold against Seattle.
Yeah, and the 49ers should turn this down because they're going to get the ball in the 20, so I would be surprised if they made Fiegel's punt it again.
Right.
Holding, number 57 of the kicking team. Prior to the kick, penalty is declined. Touchback, timeout.
So 5:02 remaining now in the fourth. The 49ers, 7-point lead, and the ball at their own 20. When we come back to Seattle. MLS Cup coming your way Sunday here on ABC. The New England Revolution, Bob Kraft owns that team. The LA Galaxy with Carlos Ruiz. You see Taylor Twellman, the up-and-coming star, in action for the Revolution this Sunday at 1:30 Eastern time. MLS Cup soccer right here on ABC. Now back to the other football from the 20-yard line on first down. Garcia falls down and gets back up under pressure and slings it away incomplete. Lamar King put the pressure on.
And that's one, because he was outside the tackle box, he can sling it away. And now Seattle, the Seahawks have to come up with two big defensive plays here, because if they can stop the 49ers, not let them get the first down, then they're going to get the ball back and have pretty good field position. Now the 49ers, if they can get a couple of first downs, then when Seattle does get the ball back, they won't have as good a field position. So this is all about field position right here.
Second and 10, showing blitz. Keep it on the ground. Great move, slip move by Barlow. Good, tough, hard running, and he comes up a yard shy of the first down. Boy, is he a good looking back.
Yeah, he really is. And, you know, he worked out this offseason with Terrell Owens, and he completely changed his body. I mean, he went from a little softer body to a pretty hard body. But the thing that impresses me about him is he has moves on moves. You know, some running backs hit a hole and they just run right downhill. I mean, that's a Denver Broncos style, a lot of stuff. This Kevin Barlow hits a hole, then makes a move, then makes another move, then makes another move.
Third down, short two. Barlow again, gets enough. Keeps the clock running and looking ahead now. Seattle, only the other side of the country, had to use a timeout earlier, so they're down to two plus the two-minute warning.
Yeah, and Mike Holmgren knows now. You know, you take a coach like Mike Holmgren, who is an offensive guy, and they always want the ball back. I mean, you know, get the ball back for me. Let me go back to work. Let me do something. And when they get a first down like that, he knows that the 49ers have just bought a little more time.
First and 10 from the 31.
Ooh. Did they jump? Yes, they did. Lamar King.
Yeah, that's Bill Levy, the referee there. He's from San Jose, and he was a policeman for 11 years in San Jose, and he was a firefighter for 17
neutral
years.
Neutral zone infraction. Number 92. Defense came in the neutral zone, caused the offense to false start. 5-yard penalty. First down.
You know, a guy that, you know, devotes his time and his life to being a policeman and a fireman. There's a lot of tough guys out on this field, and I'll tell you, the referee is one of them.
It's his first Monday night game, second year as a ref. I think that his crew has done a very good job out.
Yeah, I mean, you just feel when he's there, and it's the most important thing to feel that he's in control.
He's in control, and the game has been very nicely paced. First and five from the 36-yard line. And this is Barlow. To me, the officiating crew, it's not just about getting the calls right. There's a pace. And this game has had a nice, fairly rapid pace.
Right, because there are sometimes they'll make a call and then they'll go and they'll get together in a huddle and then they'll change the call and all those kinds of things that we haven't seen.
Updating the 49ers right now, Garcia, 202 yards. Hurst averaging a little over 4 yards a carry. Came into the game into the fives. And Owens with the two touchdowns.
I tell you, Owens' runs aren't there, but Owens had some, Garcia had some big runs tonight.
Second and three, Barlow. And now, third down. Clock still ticking down. The Seahawks still not choosing to take a timeout, and I'm looking, the play clock and the game clock are totally matched up here. This can tick all the way down to the 2-minute warning.
Yeah, he should have taken a timeout.
I agree.
And the fact that he didn't take it right off the bat, he can't take it now. He has to let it go down to 2 minutes.
Exactly.
Steve Mariucci just realized what you said.
Exactly. I was looking at the clock, and they're perfectly synced, and this is going to take it to the 2-minute warning. I agree. This was a timeout that should have been taken at the end of the last play.
And it should have been at 37 seconds.
Right. He's going to have to stop him here anyway. Better to stop on the other side of the 2-minute warning. So be it. 2 minutes to go. Pepsi post-game show live from the field. The horse trailer player of the game. A horse.
This is going to be a tough one tonight.
Very tough. A kingdom for my horse. Who said that? Streisand? Shakespeare? King Richard? Tough call.
One of the above.
Third down and two from the 39-yard line. Big, big play. And Garcia's going to move the chains. Slides to a halt at the 50. And Seattle will have two timeouts, but they've given up the first down.
And
here, that
was a heck of a call, because they knew that they were going to gang up in the run. And so they fake the run in there, and then Jeff Garcia bootlegs to the left. Watch him here. They're all going to hit this run when they start in there. Garcia's going to fake it and come out here. But watch how they sell it. Boom, right now. And look at all this defense right here. They all go in there, and Jeff Garcia just bootlegs out to the left. It's a first down. But that was a heck of a call. You know, when you have a guy that can run a little like Jeff Garcia, that gives you a big advantage.
Now they'll take a timeout here. They can only stop it once more. And the 49ers can chew up almost all of the clock. Timeout remaining for the Seattle Seahawks. San Francisco on top, 28-21, looking to go to 4-1. The Cardinals will be next at 3-2. And Seattle, this would be a very distressing loss for that team. They had the lead, came from behind, erased a 10-point deficit. Looked like they were in position to win the game, and now they're going to limp in 1-4.
They played well. And you know, the big play for the 49ers was that Cheeky O'Keefer play. Remember when he tips the ball, then that becomes an interception. Then
huge.
The 49ers were able to take that ball and go and score with it. So it kind of started right there.
Well, Dilfer paid for both interceptions tonight. They'll take a knee here. Seattle will take a timeout here. And now you'll have a third down coming up, and they can run the clock after that play. Monday Night Football being brought to you by Budweiser, brewed fresh in America. By McDonald's, Capital One, what's in your wallet? And Ford, no boundaries.
You know, for the horse trailer, what I'm thinking of, Al, and I don't know what you think here, but Cheeky O'Keefer, as I said, made that big play. I think, you know, I mean, I'd haul him around. And
yeah.
then you think of, you know, Terrell Owens, he caught the touchdown passes, so, you know, he probably deserves to be there. But then how about the guy that threw it to him, Jeff Garcia, and, you know, and the runs that he made. I mean, not only the throws that he made, I mean, his stats aren't going to be real big, but I think what Jeff Garcia did tonight was pretty good.
And then you saw on the other bench, I mean, it's hard to give it to a losing player, but Bobby Engram had a phenomenal night.
Yeah, I mean, maybe we could set a precedent there and give it to Bobby Engram, well, too.
I'll tell you what, third down and 10. And this will write a complete finish to the game on a run by Kevin Barlow to the 25-yard line. So Kevin Barlow has wrapped it up with a 26-yard run, and Mike Holmgren, formerly a San Francisco assistant, Steve Mariucci was then on his staff when Mike was at Green Bay, will back to camp tomorrow across the lake with a 1-4 record.
Yeah, and that's tough. I mean, you could just see what coaching does to someone and the highs and lows. And I was talking to Mike about this the other day, that the longer you're in it, the lows and the losses hurt a lot more than the wins feel good.
Especially one like this, which could have been the turning point, the pivotal point in a Seahawks season. Instead of being one back and winning on a Monday night, they are three back and a record of 1-5. Terrell Owens tonight, six catches, 84 yards, two touchdowns. Steve Mariucci taking his team back to the Bay with a record of 4-1. Seattle going to St. Louis next week. San Francisco heading to New Orleans. 28-21, San Francisco. Niners win at 28-21. There was really no one dominant player, so we're going to sort of cop out a little bit here, but why not? We've got, well, Garcia had a nice night. Owen scored two touchdowns. O'Keefer made the big play. And on the losing side, we just had to acknowledge Bobby Engram. So we're going to have a four-way horse trailer.
Yeah, and I think that's good. I mean, you know, because it's always the winner and all that. But what Bobby Engram did, it's not only, you know, catching the ball in the middle and all those, but how about that punt return? I mean, that was Bobby Engram really stepped up big for Seattle tonight.
Got a whole stable on the side of the horse trailer.
But that's good. It should be out and slapped all over the
right.
joint and then haul them across the country.
Melissa, who do you have?
All right, Al. Six catches for 84 yards, two touchdowns. What was the key to taking advantage of the Seahawks defense?
Well, we just had to be patient on offense. Just chip away. Garrison and Barlow definitely got some holes. And, you know, we started out passing the ball. We got some things thrown downfield. So we're just trying to take advantage of every opportunity that we had.
At the end of the second quarter, you were visibly upset. What were you saying to Steve Mariucci?
I mean, it was to the point, I mean, I was beating guys and, you know, we just wasn't connecting for whatever reason. And, you know, I was just trying to work hard, trying to get open, and I was open and they just didn't see me. So, you know, it gets frustrating at times. I'm trying to compete, trying to be the guy for this team, and, you know, I wasn't getting the ball.
All right. I've never seen someone take a pen out of their sock and sign a ball in the end zone. Do you always keep a pen in your sock?
Hey, it was just a situation. We was in the third quarter. I knew we was going this way. I knew fourth quarter we were going to be going toward Sean Springs Suite. I told my buddy, and he had already told me, if I score, give him the ball. And I asked my trainer to get me a pen, and I knew I was going to score. It was just a matter of time.
Unbelievable.
Hey, I'm just trying to be creative, just trying to have fun.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
All right, so the Niners take a one-game lead in the NFC West, Al.
Too many synapses in that mind, I'm telling you. 49ers win it 28-21. This has been the Pepsi Postgame Show. And next week we go to Pittsburgh. The Steelers will be hosting the Colts. Stay tuned now for Nightline after your late local news. For those of you on the West Coast, an ABC News special report about the fatality in Falls Church, Virginia. Al Michaels, John Madden, and Melissa Stark saying good night from Seattle, where the 49ers go to 4-1 with a win over the Seahawks.